Hi guys, and welcome back to VHS episode 4, and oh wow, what an episode we have for you today. Not one, not two, but three guests. The three musketeers of death skateboards are joining us here live on the luxurious brown leather sofa. Mark Nicolson, Dan Cates, and the man, Nick Zorlac. Guys, welcome to Sheffield, welcome to the show, welcome to the sofa, how are you?
Thank you very much. Very good, yeah.
It's all right. So this is a first. We've had one guest, we've even had two, but to have a whole trio of you is a real pleasure for us and the guys here. We have got a whole bunch of stuff to get through on this fine evening here in Yorkshire. We're going to talk about DVDs. We're going to talk about skateboards. There's about, we were Googling them, Nick, and we found at least 200 or 300 different graphics. So we're going to go through, hopefully, what is now 21 years of death.
Yep.
Your guys' story, and we want to go right back to the beginning and basically maybe start with you, Nick, and tell us, before we talk about death skateboarding and death skateboards, maybe where just riding a skateboard started for yourself.
Saw it in the late 70s, was when I was a little kid. I was blown away by it, never seen anything like it, and I wanted it in as soon as I saw it.
This is the late 70s?
Yeah.
What do skateboards look like in the late 70s?
Just thin little things, like Fiberflex type things.
Not even fish, like fish boards is 80s, right? So like this, you're talking about literally like...
Kind of a bit like penny boards, I suppose.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
that was what there was. And yeah. Just saw it and yeah, just wanted to be part of it.
So there you go. Dan, you can't have been a 70s era man. You must have been 80s, right? Mark's already laughing. Mark, you feel free to jump in. Were you a 70s man? I doubt it. That beard might make you look a little bit older, but you ain't going back that. You ain't going back that old.
You were born in the 80s, right?
81, yeah.
Oh, there you go. 81. Can't have been. What were you born, like 70s? Maybe.
76.
All right.
Yeah.
But
no, I started in 87.
Skating?
Yeah.
That is full fish era then.
Yeah.
And Mark?
I always had a skateboard when I was like every kid had a skateboard in the garage, like a bike, mountain bike or something. Yeah. I had a little skateboard to mess about on, but I saw a magazine for the first time and was like, oh, you can do more than just going down a hill on it. And that was 91.
So there's 12 years between really, so, you know, when you guys started.
I didn't identify myself as a skateboard until in the sort of 80s.
Right.
In the mid to late 80s.
How old are you when you get your first board and you see this kind of thing?
I must have been like 7, 8 years old.
Real early then.
Yeah.
So you're 91, you're mid 80s, you're 79. Where does, when you started, were people doing tricks then? Or they literally kind of like, because on Facebook now you start to see these footage of like old BBC shows and these show skaters in the 70s. And I don't see any of them even ollieing back then. It seems to literally just be kind of going up homemade park pipes.
That was basically it, messing about really.
Yeah.
Pogos and like nose wheelies and stuff, I think. Yeah, no, there was like the early kickflips.
Yeah, yeah.
Where you put your foot underneath the board and flip it over like
that. Yeah. When, so going back to kind of like you guys all starting skating, did you go through the other sports first? We didn't get it out of Grove as an admission, but we're pretty sure you rollerbladed for a couple of weeks before you picked up the skateboard.
Not
that. Sorry, Grove. But Halford, who came on, did admit that he went through the roll, but look, I went through it all. I had rollerblades, I had a weird scooter with suspension.
Whoa.
I know it's terrible. I think I even had might not have been a BMX trials bike. Did you guys kind of go through them before you found skating, or was it found that and that was it?
I liked bikes, but yeah. I liked skate, always liked skating as well.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I still like bikes.
Yeah. So you skip through, you're going through. When do you guys, I'm assuming you come into this later on, Mark, but you guys, when do you meet skating? I mean, if it's 20 years of death, you guys, you've been there since step one. You, Ronnie, and Mark are the original death guys, right? From 20 years ago, am I right in thinking?
21 years ago.
But you met Mark, you met Dan before the start of death skateboards.
Oh yeah, a long time before, yeah. I think we met at the Pioneer, didn't we?
Yeah.
The good old Pioneer.
Yeah, St. Albans, yeah.
Was that a pub, skate spot? I don't know what the title was.
I think it's the oldest indoor skate park in the UK.
Yeah.
I've not given...
In St. Albans?
In Hertfordshire.
You know they have comps here. They used to have comps back in the day.
They used to have...
just the best.
Yeah.
Ever.
Incredible comps.
Like how people talk about the old Northampton comps at Redlands.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like
yeah.
that sort of era of like it was Northampton at one time in the year and it was Pioneer at St. Albans at the other time. And everyone went to that one. And it's just insane. So I'm sure probably loads and loads of skaters that are probably have been friends for life that met skating at the Pioneer.
Yeah.
I definitely met everyone I skate with now, probably.
I met to some degree. Yeah, I met Pritch and Dainton at the Pioneer. We were hiding in the toilets.
Why?
We were locked with like me, Rodney, and someone else, we when it closed, this is the date, night before the comp, we went, because it had like a club at the back, so we went into the disabled toilet and locked it, and we were going to stay there until like all the staff had locked up and gone,
and then try and come back out again.
And then when the coast was clear, we're going to go back in to, so we could like just session all night and have like, you know, private practice for the comp, get our lines down. But they were having like a like some teeny boppers disco in the back hall,
right.
So they, it was just chaos. There was just like youth workers everywhere, so we couldn't get out of the disabled toilet.
So you go and you lock yourself in.
Yeah,
you're all high five, and this is going to be great.
Yeah,
you wait. it all quiets down. You decide to make the great escape, and
Yeah. So there was a tiny little window in the side. You know how they're like, you know, like it starts 6 feet up, so like, and tiny.
Yeah, yeah.
So we decided we were going to climb out of that, and that leads it to where the mini ramp was outside. But I was like useless, and I was the young. I was probably about 16 or whatever. I couldn't really get out of the window, and I was like stuck. Like my head and like arms are outside the window, and then my legs are just kicking inside the toilet. And it's because it's the night before the comp. Loads of people have come down in cars from like Manchester, and it's just people lurking around.
Yeah.
And everyone from Cardiff was there, and it was. And Dainton had to pull me.
He's a Welshman too.
Through the window, and that's where I met him.
So you, Pritchard, and Dainton by then. Are these guys older than you? Or are you all the same kind of age?
They're slightly older.
Because I want to come. That's a real interesting point that we got to get to. There's a couple of years on, which is you guys. So you finding these guys and having Pritchard and Dainton, who obviously went on to become huge stars in their own right, and obviously you're really tight. Just saw you the other day. You were with Lee, mm-hmm. right? You were at a concert, or where did you go with Lee? You were somewhere at some kind of festival or something very recently.
Oh yeah, we went to see Jazzy Jeff at there Dreamland in Margate.
Did you hear Jazzy Jeff? What was that like?
Jazzy Jeff was really bad.
Excellent.
It was just rubbish.
Recommend, get your tickets now.
But but we went because I'd heard he was really good, mm-hmm. and DJ Yoda was before him, opened up.
Yep.
Who was amazing as usual.
Yeah.
So that kind of saved the day. Yeah.
So you should have left after Yoda and before Mr. Jazzy Jeff came out.
Yeah, we kind of split halfway through Jazzy Jeff. So
I want to come back to the Pritchard and Dainton stuff. It's a real interesting kind of like part of that.
So what I was going to say was,
yeah.
your question, don't forget that skateboarding was a lot smaller and more tight-knit then.
Mm-hmm.
So you'd go to comps and everyone would be at the comps. And it wasn't really like I found people, it was like they were my friends already.
Mm-hmm.
I think the first time I saw Ron was at Wakefield. I don't know if Ron will remember, he had a black eye. He's doing fronts and flips every single go, and I was like, who's this maniac? I like him.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, I remember the black eye, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, I thought the same.
You give it to him, did you?
Yeah. This is kind of like Nine. This is kind of like the Nine Club, you know, like when they like
that,
they're like, you never see them, they're like off screen, aren't they?
Yeah.
Like Guy Mariano's like talking in the background or whatever.
Yeah, you hear them off camera.
We got
Ronnie.
We
can talk, Ronnie. We just don't have a mic pack, that's all.
Yeah.
But you can still shout if he's got any kind of little quibs to chuck in. I'm sure he's more than welcome to. So what, go on.
Are we allowed to mention other shows, rival shows?
You can mention, we're all friends here.
Okay.
We're all friends here, we're not in competition at all.
I just want to clarify, at the end, mm-hmm. do we get some like VHS gear? You know, like they get the Nine Club gear.
Right, when we get some more, you know, when we get some of the bread, then we'll be talking about some t-shirts. But you do have pink gin and tonic in a mug there. So
this is tea. What are you talking about?
Pink gin and tonic in a mug. You see this? This is his stash down here that he's trying to hide.
I was trying to look all classy.
Yeah, it's well classy, man.
Good luck. Good luck.
In the teapot.
You know how like you know people who like they don't really drink and they want to look all and they like have a bottle of like vodka or whatever, but it's really just emptied and filled with water. And
you're the opposite.
Yeah, I'm doing the opposite. Yeah, I'm trying to hide because I never drink anyway.
So what's the special? Yeah, exactly.
Well, never.
Just tea, loads of tea.
Well, I mean, like maybe once a week.
The tea makes him go mad though.
Yeah, send him a week.
Hey, like that.
Lay your hair down, or you know, whatever you got in your hair. So, who did you meet first out of Dan, Mark, and Ron?
Dan.
So you met Dan.
Yes.
And then obviously one's been Ronnie. You'll have come with a counterpart because there's obviously the Calow brothers, which were both did the same time.
When Ronnie and Danny got on, it was through Bingo and Mischief.
Yep.
And I told Bingo about that I was starting this new company and stuff. And if I remember rightly, I think Ronnie and Danny were interested through when I mentioned it to Bingo.
Yeah, and they were kicked. So,
and I'd not, I knew him from going up to comps
think
and stuff.
Sent us Transit and Supernova.
Okay, yeah.
Through Power. And
yes,
then,
yes.
And then this was just about the same time as, yeah, you were starting the company. And we were like...
Oh, so you were flowing in other stuff.
Yeah.
And then started.
Yeah, but we only got one board. So, and then Death started and we were like, look, let's just do that.
Yeah, and I'd seen them guys at around
Kate,
the comps and stuff.
I don't even think Kate was on the team then. I think that was Tattoo Al and Cactus and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Remember?
Yeah. No, I can't remember. But you're right. No, thank you.
And then you kind of went, look, I'm going to do it properly. And then these two went.
Yeah, because
that was it.
That's right. Yeah, because
skateboard does it. I think
yes. That. Yeah, that's right.
So who was
because initially,
it was kind of
going to be like. If for lack of a better way of saying it, like the Spinal Tap of skateboarding, it was going to be a spoof company.
Yeah.
I just wanted to do it, and I thought no one would be interested, and I thought the kids would hate the skull. Some of them probably do. But I stuck a sticker on the Big Worm's skate shop door, Herman's skate shop door, and he was like, all the kids are asking for the boards. When are you making the boards? And I was like, what? They want them? Really? And he was like, yeah, when are you making them? And one of the kids that was asking for the boards was Mark. I found out years later.
The shop Big Worms, that was in Harlow, which is like the next town over from where I live.
Yeah.
And Harlow was the town that had like a cinema and it had like a ski slope. And it was like where I was from, which is Hoddesdon, which was just sort of 5 miles away, sort of was just like one of them towns where it's just like the main street. And there's a few shops and it's just sort of a bit, there's nothing to do. So anyone that was into anything got to the age where you get on the bus or the train to Harlow and you go to Harlow.
Yep.
So I was over in Harlow a lot anyway, just as a kid, just to like go to the ski slope, you know, doing stuff like that, go to the cinema, someone's birthday or something. So going to Harlow, obviously, as soon as Hemming opened the skate shop, Big Worms, it was just somewhere to go all the time. You just get the bus to Harlow, go to the shop. And then, one day I was there and I was like, Hemming, what's this sticker, like this mad death skateboard thing? And the other guy was Joe Gray, who's a tattooist now. I think he lives in Australia. He's best guy ever. But he was in loads of bands and stuff, punk bands and that. But he was like, man, Mark, if you... I was like super good pals. And he's like, Mark, you seen this thing? I was like, what is this? Like, the other guy, Monk from Harlow, who's the best guy. Like, I haven't seen him for a little while, but he's great. But basically, we were all just like, what is this thing? This looks well sick. Like, just because it was just... Skating seemed to be so like specific at the time, like it was really a certain way, and there's very few things that were kind of like.
Was it just
striking? I guess it was just like, what is this? So you couldn't miss
Mark
it.
Mark saw what I was doing, which was
sticker. It was just a sticker,
but not it didn't say their skateboards. Just the skull.
No,
it didn't say their skateboards. So basically, what we're looking at over here on the end, the traditional.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, this
that,
one here.
That exact.
There
that
we
guy.
Are.
Yeah,
so you see this.
That was it.
And you kind of made this as a...
It was just stuck on the...
It was stickers and T-shirts.
So you made it, someone sees it, and you go, oh, people like that, okay, I can run that on a board.
I thought no one would like it, but then Mark and Joe and them and Monk and them guys, they kind of saw what I was trying to do. And then, because of them, I started it.
So when you
and
start...
then, I think, let me try and remember. So, Robbie Reed, Adam Cook, Cactus, Tattoo Al...
Cactus.
Yeah, Cactus was on for a moment.
Yeah, right.
For a moment, yeah.
I think there was
I'm
one
trying to remember.
Everyone in it.
Yeah,
and
who else?
Well, like a list.
Who else was
there?
Right
list.
At the beginning.
It was in a magazine. That was all. That
like sticker flow list.
Yeah.
Or...
maybe Reese the Peace.
Reese
the Peace.
This guy.
I tried to ignore him, Mark, but you brought him to light.
Come and land on me.
There we are.
Didn't you like tell Reese the Peace that he was on when you were drunk, and then like
no.
just didn't give him? He never got anything.
You did. No, that wasn't it. No, that was...
Are you promising pro boards? Promising sponsorships
we
and not following through?
I swear.
No, we were at a party and we were like...
Yeah.
If you jump out of a window, we'll give something. Just
naked.
Eat.
And
I can't remember
and
that.
He went...
And then the police come and then he told him the police that I'd beaten him up and the police were trying to take me away. We used to do those stupid parties and
I
stuff.
I don't think you deserved a sponsorship after that.
No,
right,
that's what happened. That's,
then,
what,
bloke,
that's
yeah.
what blew it. Yeah.
So just before we talk about the initiation of death, it sounds like from what Ron's saying and what I've heard, you were distributing... Supernaut and something else before, and then you were like, well, I'm more distributing, so I'll just kind of bring my own thing to this. Is that right? So you started your while you were doing that?
How that started was, I really liked Consolidated because they had a fucking amazing team and really funny adverts and stuff, and they were kind of against the grain. And to me, they were kind of what skateboarding was about.
I still to this day, definitely. This amazing, like, still. Amazing message.
Yeah. And I'd see Thrasher, I'd skate to Tower Records and I'd get Thrasher and I'd be like, oh, sick, this is sick. And at their adverts, it said not available in the UK. And I kept seeing it every month and I was like, if I don't call them, someone else is going to.
Yeah.
And I didn't have a job at the time and stuff, so I called Consolidated and I was like, look, I faxed him. It was all faxes back then. I was like, look, I skate and I want to do this distribution company. And they faxed back and they were like, yeah, let's talk about it. And I couldn't believe it.
No way.
That was my first brand I started distributing 23 years ago.
And he's still faxing today.
No, still got the fax machine.
Yeah.
So you've obviously been a skater, you're fine skating at seven, you go, I'm assuming you do it for your teenage years, so the 80s.
Oh, yeah.
Then, is there a moment where you go, you know what, I want to be involved in skateboarding forever? Or did you go off and do something else? What brought you into working in skate as opposed to just being a skateboarder?
I was skating every day when I finished like college and all that stuff, and working here and there. And my dad got me a job at a furniture fair in Cologne in Germany.
You went to Germany to work?
Yeah, just to work at this furniture, lugging stuff about at this furniture place.
Bit of a commute, isn't it?
Yeah, it was a bit of a commute. Yeah, it's expensive. Yeah.
So you get the.
It was free beer and food all day. It was pretty sick.
So off to Germany you go to make furniture.
To just lug stuff about and help on this trade stand and stuff.
Is that when you saw Herrick there?
Yeah. Yeah, I can't believe it. Yeah, I was
Dan? What was he doing?
Conte?
I don't know.
Oh, this is our soul that we know. He just bumped into him at this furniture fair in the middle of Germany.
Right. So I was working this furniture fair.
What year is it?
What now? I don't know.
No.
2019.
It was 95.
So you're 95. You're in Germany. You're in a furniture shop. And
but just a side little story. I was working at this furniture fair, and after a couple of days, I was like, I'm going to go into town and check it out, see what's going on. I went into town, and who did I see? Martin Herrick. I couldn't believe it. And we went to this party at Bond University. It was rad.
So gutted if you saw him.
But so all these people were chatting to me at this place, and they were like, what are you into? I was like, I skate all the time, I love skateboarding, blah, blah, blah. And every single person was like, why don't you get a job in skateboarding? I was like, yeah, that'd be great, if possible. Hmm. And then I worked for a distribution company in England for a bit, repping, I think I was the first rep for DC Shoes in early 96.
Right.
And Drawers Clothing. Busted my back doing that job, some stuff happened. And while I was recovering, that was when I hit up Consolidated and I was like, can I distribute your stuff?
Send the fax over.
Yeah, they said yes.
Yeah.
I started distributing Consolidated. Then I got, I think, Black Label and a few other bits and bobs that we were just talking about. Some companies that unfortunately came and went. They went out of business, unfortunately, but Consolidated to this day.
Yeah.
Heroin, the first distributor for heroin stuff.
With the landscape in England. Stuff as well?
Landscape stuff. Yeah, a bunch of other companies now.
Did you get the Blast stuff as well? Is that right?
I do, yeah. And Fabric, film
fabric
trucks.
Stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, so...
Is this all out of... We're going to be all over the timeline here, but is this out of the infamous Death House? There's a smirk of yours. Is this out of the infamous Death House, which I visited on a number of occasions? I mean, I also believe no one's been to and been thrown out of before, which is nice. So it's always nice to get people that have come and been asked to leave. That's not on screen. Always makes an appearance.
Did he get thrown out?
Yeah, you probably don't remember, and you probably just, you know...
Harry's fault.
There you go. Oh, sorry. Harry's fault, so... Yeah, sorry. But is this the infamous house in
Harrow, yeah. I do work at a house, but I have got lockups as well.
Okay.
Too many keys, too much responsibility.
That isn't where you started, though. That's not where... I'm trying to figure out where you first made this fax, where you are, and you got these consolidated boards.
I was at my folks' house.
Yep.
And I started it out at my folks' house in the back room of their house.
Wow.
And that was great, because it was a low overhead.
Mm-hmm. And then at some point, I'm assuming you get so many, you think, you know, I've got to take this out to somewhere.
It was time to move out, and... I think the first house in Harrow that I worked out of, I used to sleep and work out of one room. So I'd have a bed that I could just chuck on the floor and sleep and had all the boards around me and stuff.
Yeah, wow.
It's pretty sick and it was nice and cheap. But then, of course, it gets to the stage where you need more space.
It was a shithole, but it was cheap.
Yeah, I think most skaters have been through that sentence many, many times. It was a shithole, but it was cheap.
It had a really good... What about the ramp and the bowl?
Which bowl is this? Is this the one that's in a lot of the old clips?
Oh, the little one, yeah.
Is it yellow? Was it yellow?
It was like...
There's all sorts, isn't it?
All different colours.
Like puke.
It's all different colours.
Yeah.
I think
it was like a sort of green screen green for one point, wasn't it? If you find those tapes, we could probably make like do something with it.
Make the bowl disappear in the footage.
Yeah, that was and just delete the footage.
Bowl, actually. That was just a really small bowl, and we had a ramp in the garden as well. Oh, that was funny. Hitcher, who used to live at the house, James Hitchcock's BMX, so he skates a little bit as well. He said to the next door neighbour, oh, is it all right if I have a mini ramp in the garden? And she was like, yeah, you can have a mini ramp. I think she was expecting like a little fly off.
Yeah.
He built this fucking, what was it, 6 foot mini ramp?
Yeah, it was big.
And it was the whole width for the garden.
Yeah,
it was fence to fence, wasn't it?
And you could pretty much see in their bathroom when you stood on the platform. Yeah. She was a bit shocked by that one.
This isn't her house, it's the house before.
It was the previous house.
And you had a bowl and all that, because obviously there was a mini ramp and stuff in
And a bowl behind the ramp. So the whole garden was a ramp and a bowl, and that was it. And you could
barely walk past the ramp. This is where you got your, oh, but you know, quite like that bowl on the old back garden thing, because you went on and followed suit with that. Which again, we might, just while we're on the subject of it, what on earth made you build a bowl? And because it's a bit kit, that, isn't it?
Which one?
Well, you tell me. I've
both of them.
Yeah,
the first one is like
a grand, didn't you, on the first one?
A grand.
Yeah, it's like about this deep. It's like you'd need a nuclear bomb to get rid of that. Like,
yeah, it's really like it's thicker than a public skate park. Actually, yeah. It's,
wow.
Yeah.
I tell you what,
a grand. It's like this big.
Yeah.
Like a public skate park's maybe 6 inches thick. Like to be with like regulation. Yeah. This was 10.
Okay.
It's
a meaty bit.
So gnarly. Yeah.
You learn from the first one, make the same what. Yeah. The second one.
I liked
more.
It. I thought
it was really good. Yeah. People like say. Because like people have seen Squadrophenia and the bowl's in there and it says it's unskateable and all the rest. And it was like, it's as small as you could go with a bowl, wasn't it? Basically.
Pretty much.
Well, it's the nose just didn't scrape on the way up, wasn't it?
Wow. So
the
only on the I mean, it was
but just missed the toe
top. But you could skate it, couldn't you, once you figured it out?
Smash around, yeah.
People say, oh, that's a load of shit or whatever, and it sort of was. If you like, say you travelled from Scotland to stay at the house, oh yeah, they got a bag of a bowl because like nobody had one.
If and you'd be like, oh,
is this it?
You'd be like, where is it?
I remember when Preston stayed at the house, and like I had a section that was on an extra on the Thrasher DVD in the bowl, and then like I filmed like three video parts on it in like a year.
So it looks good value, bowl.
Yeah. Well, because it was in a rented house.
Oh yeah, it was rented, yeah.
Like, basically, and nobody
else... So you didn't get your deposit back then, I'm assuming, when they found a concrete monstrosity in the back of the garden. Say goodbye to that.
That's just the tip of the iceberg.
The house was not inhabitable when we left. It was fucked.
You look proud of that, Dan.
It barely was when we moved in.
So shit.
But it got repossessed. The house got repossessed. Yeah, nothing to do with us. The geezer that owned
it. Nothing to do with you, or is that just...
No, the bloke wasn't paying the mortgage, and then they just repossessed it. So we had about 6 months for free, because we were... Like legally, the tenants.
And
there.
This is still in the house paying. Before the house. Exactly, this is the one before, right?
So this is the previous one. Yeah.
So when do you come to the Harrow house that a lot of people have?
The House of Doom 3 was 2002, wasn't it, or 3?
Yeah, like March 2002.
Yeah, and that's the current one.
That's the current one. 3.
They've all been in Harrow, in Harrow, haven't they?
Pardon? Sorry.
They've all been in Harrow, haven't they?
Yes. Yeah.
Just
they've all been in Harrow. You've been in the third one.
And the reason we lived in Harrow was because. We moved there because of the skate park and the skate scene.
Yeah, the...
solid surf skate park in Harrow.
Yeah.
Which we saved many times.
With the really severe...
Gnarly
what do you call it? Yeah, is that hot like...
Yeah, I didn't move there for that. I thought it was shit, but I just moved there because that's the only place where, like, in London that I knew.
And you can just make your own ball wherever you are anyway, so it doesn't matter. If you don't like anyone else, you just make your own.
I love the skate park, for the record.
So it's 1998, you're... I'm trying to stay on for you. You're doing Supernaut, you're doing a bunch of stuff.
So Power started in 96, and it was like those brands that I said to begin with, Consolidated is the only one from then, but soon after Heroin and Landscape and so on. And then Death started in 98.
And you start there, you speak to Kate, you speak to Nixon, you speak to Ronnie, but when you say the three you mentioned earlier, you didn't mention Danny. Was Danny not part of the original... on the team, or did they both come as a package?
No, they were there. It was both.
So that, is it
package
the four?
Deal.
Is that the four that
fucking
started?
No, I can't remember. Can anyone remember?
We did our first advert with Buzz 5.
Yeah, that was
me, Danny, and us.
It's kind of like it sort of started, and then it's sort of started proper.
How would you describe it?
It's really difficult to even remember. Basically, it started. And it was all a bit of a laugh.
He weren't pro boards.
And it still is all a bit
start.
Of a laugh.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I didn't even have any boards, like I said.
Yeah.
And then I think just some people weren't they just like, you know, we kind of went our separate ways. Nothing bad or anything, just people kind of, you know, went different directions. And then when these guys got on, that just became the sort of foundation of what it is now.
Yep. Were you skating for anybody before, Dan?
Oh, well, I...
Were you playing Solid?
No. I used to get boards from Slam, believe it or not. All
right, yeah. What, Slam boards or
Slam City skates? Yeah. I just used to get, like, because they had the distribution.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd get like Toy Machine boards or Planet Earth boards or Zero boards.
Okay, so more of a distribution kind of thing as opposed to like
And then that I kind of got the boot, and
that's boot.
And Nick was there,
and then Nick came to the rescue, and I was sponsored by.
Most brands that I distributed.
Yeah, but the first board that I got was a Maple board.
Yeah,
Maple.
I distributed Maple.
I think it was a Jason Carney board. I got because when I first, the first time I ever went to America, we actually stayed with him and he was really cool. So I had this Jason Carney board, which I think I bought at cost because Nick was so small then. And then he got me hooked up with Zorlac, and I had like this like full. Like Mosher gear, like, you know, like, well, I mean, pus head gear and like.
Yeah, because Zorlac came back for a bit in its original format, Jeff Newton running it. Then there was a problem with the trademark or something, and then it stopped again. But for a brief while, I was doing Zorlac again, yeah.
Yeah. It's good.
And then kids thought I was doing my own boards that called Zorlac.
Well, yeah, well, confusing. We're going to play a little clip in a second, but being as though you brought up the name, Zorlac as opposed to the very. Rolling off the tongue name of, I want to say it right, is it Oriek? Or are we not, is it an Orio or your second name?
Orekio, yeah.
Which is very different from Zorlac and a very exotic second name. Why have you gone down, what made you be like, you know what?
It wasn't my choice, yeah. That name is from Sicily. Half my family's from Sicily.
Yeah.
But no, Zorlac was a nickname and I didn't give it to myself. Kids used to shout it at me, taking the piss out of me.
Because not kids though, it was like just
everyone,
like,
older people, kids,
yeah, but it was parents, just like it was like anyone. The people you knew, wasn't it? It was not like,
yeah, pretty much, yeah.
And it's just stuck.
A lot of different people. Basically, the reason for that was because skateboarding kind of changed from the late 80s to the early 90s. Obviously, it changed massively,
mm-hmm.
and I kind of still look like I belonged in the last decade,
mm-hmm. in the year before,
yeah. And the tricks I did sort of belong there, like wall rides, bonuses, that sort of stuff,
yeah.
Yeah, but he was good at them.
Still good at him now. Yeah. I've seen him in the mini ramp earlier.
You're too kind. people would shout Zorlac at me, taking the piss.
What are you trying to say? Is it you're a bit of a swamp trog?
Basically.
Yeah. Because he had the
definition swamp trog.
Well, he had the, like, it had become 92 or whatever, you know.
And he weren't there.
And everyone's like,
he hadn't caught up.
Adidas Gazelles, pants bigger than your nan's dress, and like.
Like what Thiago Lemos is doing now, that everyone was doing in 92 with the huge double XLs and the big baggy
and Nick had dreads.
Ah, so different vibe to the to the rest of the guys in.
Yeah,
and just like sort of black clothes.
Yeah.
Did you have
roughly what it looked like now, but thinner?
I don't think I did
back then. Not quite back then.
But what, remember when you got those dreads done in Thailand?
Oh yeah.
They were amazing. I wanted them.
You should get some.
Yeah.
Well, I sort of did, didn't I? But like, I didn't go to a place that was as good as the one you went to.
No.
So of all the things that some people recommend to go to Thailand for, my uncle found a wife out there, didn't go right. So dreads is something that you're recommending. It's just the thing to go for.
Absolutely.
And food.
If
you've still
got
hair.
The food's good.
And food as well.
Yeah.
Not the girls.
Wait, that's horrible.
I want to show, it's taken us a while just to get to the year 2000.
Remember that advert for cigars? It was like...
With like a crow's foot.
And he's like this, and then the flap.
Well, no, crow's wing, not a crow's foot. Crow's wing. What is it, a crow's wing?
Crow's wing.
What they had in the 70s? Crow's wing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sorry.
But going back to, I think Dan summarised it well on a post you did on your Instagram, which was basically, you kind of, as a skateboarder then, you kind of wanted to look the opposite from like townies or whatever.
Yeah.
And that was kind of part of it, dreads and the whole look and all that stuff was, you wanted to look the opposite of mainstream society.
You want to look the opposite of people who suck.
And that name, I didn't give myself the name Zorlac, just to make that clear.
And that's where it came from.
Shout out at me and it stuck, yeah.
So we found ourselves in the year 2000.
Zorlac!
Roughly, where I've got a clip of which I'm hoping actually has the three of you skating some kind of hall and a mini ramp. I think I saw this many, 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 many years
Maidenhead,
ago.
Maidenhead, maybe.
You tell me, because we're going to ask Noel to get up on the old screen.
Is there, actually, is there any good skating in it?
We'll find out, won't we? I believe it's got the three of you.
He said it's us three, so...
Oh, there's Monk.
Here's
Monk.
Where's this from?
Maidenhead.
The old internet.
Oh, is this one of your tapes, Mark?
Yeah, this is one of my little things.
There he is.
Whoa. Look at that.
Oh, this is like Christmas jam, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, yeah. Somewhere in a minute, Dan gives me the indication that you're right.
Monk, yes, Monk. Harlow, that's
you,
Monk.
You just passed your test and you nearly crashed on the way home into a tree.
Here he is.
Yeah, well, we nearly crashed on the way there.
Is that a nolly tail slide?
Yeah.
I think it was, just about. What video is this from?
I was just
fishing
on the old web and found this rad clip.
Yeah, this was, I was doing YouTube for a little bit a couple of years ago.
You were doing YouTube?
Doing
yeah,
YouTube.
Well, I was editing up old tapes like this, because it's just, a couple of these clips ended up on videos, but it's like, it's just nice to have the whole session in one go, like, like a YouTube clip is nowadays, and I was editing it up with some of the youngsters from Harlow. My channel got demonetized because I didn't have enough subscribers, so Death Rider Skate Vids, subscribe. There's some cool videos. There's the Cardiel clip at Harrow, Bastion at Northampton.
Yeah. You're definitely about to make your appearance in a second. And there he is.
What the?
Yeah. Chucking sweets out to the kids.
That, like, yeah, whatever.
Have you got on that?
Well, yeah.
There's something a bit different about you in this clip to now, Dan. I can't figure out what it is. Huge mop top.
It's good to have hair.
Do you miss it?
Well,
whoa,
I mean...
Black and white.
Yeah, you sort of... Well, yeah.
That's a good move out there.
It was fucking wicked.
Why was that there? Have you gone and built... Have you not taken that down there?
I just had some sort of weird club where they build those ramps every now and then. It was really sick.
Skate club.
Just once in a blue moon it was.
Yeah, so what's brought you there? Are you doing a demo there or have you just rocked up and you just...
We just heard about it and come to skate there. Went to skate there.
It's like, you know, from time to time there's like a little skate park or a little like town hall or something.
Yeah.
And they'll have some ramps that you can build or just space to let you skate. They were always really, really warm. And the floor was always like...
It was warm.
It wasn't
it was nice.
Concrete. It was like that sports hall floor.
Yeah, yeah,
and
traditional sports hall.
And it was so bright in there, all the lights and stuff, and it was just so fun to
skate
there.
Did you edit that?
Yeah, I think so. That was, back in the day, like...
Am I right in thinking that you've done quite a lot of the editing for Nick over the years, is that correct?
Yeah, Toby Batchelor, actually, is one of the best dudes ever. He did a lot of stuff as well, like, and between me and Toby...
So, if we look here...
Have
we got them all here, Nick? I was actually asking House Rob earlier, and he was trying to tell me that there was a VHS that didn't do much of a run. I've never seen the VHS. Is that right?
You missed out.
I think it was 1,000. We made 1,000, I think.
Yeah.
VHS, yeah, that's what the movie, 1999.
Yeah, we did get a picture of it earlier, maybe we can get it up on the screen. But then, you've got a whole cast of videos here, including the brand new one, Into the Void.
Into the Void, yeah.
And, which literally is what, just a couple of
literally
weeks
just come out, there. Literally come out a week ago, about six and a bit years in the making.
Yeah.
Actually, it took so long, people were getting upset with me that it wasn't out, but it was just like,
It just takes time,
you know, for everyone to be ready when you've got so many people, so many riders.
Have they all always been a fiver as well? That seems to have been a thing, like...
Yeah, I like good value.
Yeah.
I like good value.
That's the running order.
There's the collection. Is that in order?
Right way?
Squadrofini first?
Yeah.
And then Escape from Boredom. And so, Mark, you edited these or joint edited, or what's the deal with making?
Yeah, like, I think... Whilst me and Dan were working on Squadrophenia, it was time for Escape from Boredom to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And Toby Batchelor, who's, like as I mentioned earlier, like is one of the best dudes ever, he was filming a lot and stuff, and he was really keen, and he made Escape from Boredom. Like, I think I edited my part and perhaps your part and a few other bits because it was a lot to all do at once, because I don't know how many people are on there, but it was quite a few of us. So yeah. I seem to remember we'd drive over to Toby's house. I had my computer set up there, he had his computer, and we'd drive up on a Friday and we'd stay there Saturday and all through Saturday editing, and we did that for a little while, and that Escape from Boredom happened. But that's Toby brought all that together. That was really
By the way, What an amazing process, isn't it? Editing the videos is so fun, isn't it?
And it's so fun, yeah.
Like on the last one, so many times, like there'd be a bit in a song and it would mention benches and then Moggins would be skating a bench or...
Yeah, that clip.
Very, very good, must say.
Who was it on the friend section? Like, up and down, the lyric and the Sexton Ming song.
Bazza, Barry.
Yes, yeah, Barry. And it says...
Skate interiors.
Yes, that yeah. Guy.
So just Ruler. Finding things in songs that match with...
Well, it was nice. No, by accident. No, we'd go, right, this section's looking like this. Right, what tunes have we got? Because all the music we've used in the new one is all people we know. It's pretty much skaters, isn't it? Yeah. Like, it's people that skate or have been connected to skating.
It's such a nice network of people. And, you know, and it's this video means a lot to me because some of the writers have been on for 20 years mm-hmm. and some of the people who made the music I've known for years and years as well. And putting it all together, all those cool people that I'm lucky enough to know, it's just fucking amazing for me.
Now, I remember one guy very distinctly by the name of Steak, who was a rad skating man, who was... Now, you're going to have to let me do some remembering here.
He was a rad skating man.
Yes, he really was. Long, luscious, flowing kind of like...
Mm. Wild man.
Yeah. And he, again, you're going to have to help me here, because you might be like, what are you talking about? But there was a guy that was quite a bit older, that was often hanging around in the house, and he was in the band... with Steak, and he didn't kind of fit. He was like a good 40 or 50 year old, and I was like, he was always just there.
Oh, crazy Pete!
crazy Pete.
I'm the kind of guy who just walks through you. Yeah. So you kind of sat there, you've looked on, you know, the portrait on the wall.
Who the hell is this guy? Where's this guy? Yeah, like,
Horsey's out in the garden with some girl in the garage, and you just think,
is this someone's dad? You know, like...
Who are you here to pick up, sir? You know what I mean? And he's like, oh, I'm in a band with... Have I got that right? And he used to run.
Absolutely right. Yeah, yeah. Fucking great dude. Goodness great dude. Crazy Pete. He was a Harrow skater from the 70s.
Yeah,
he's still around.
No, and he's just... I think he just kind of came in one day and was just like... You know, you just didn't sat down like it was normal. I thought, I'm going to have to say hello.
He helped me out a lot. He drove on... Because some of the tours and stuff, like, I had to... Because if Dan was on a tour, I'd have to run a distribution and pack all the boxes and stuff.
Yeah.
And Crazy helped me because he would drive the van, because obviously I couldn't drive the van on the tour and be working as well.
Yeah.
So he helped out a lot. He's a good dude, yeah.
So the reason I bring that up is, the segue there was, did any of their rocking tunes ever make it into a death video soundtrack?
The Crazy Pete in the band scenario was actually Steak, Crazy Pete and me and Dan.
Yeah.
I actually taught myself, Steak taught me how to play a few chords so I could just sort of do rhythm and he could just go nuts on the guitar. And Dan would smash TVs with baseball bats.
I was the singer.
Was the singer. So you get an idea of what his band was. I couldn't play the guitar. Crazy Pete was even worse at playing the bass to the point where when we'd play, Dan would just turn his hand off.
He
was just not playing. You would just turn it, we'd start and it'd sound awful.
Fucking shit.
And every time he went that way, he'd turn it down until it was off. Like,
yeah. Right, so.
He's a clever dude though.
So if you watch, The Filth and the Fury or any documentary about the Sex Pistols, and they talk about playing mm-hmm. and they talk about Sid. Mm-hmm. They say that most of the time he was turned off and there was someone behind a curtain playing.
Right.
Because he couldn't play.
Okay.
Right? He's just there for show because he's John Lydon's best friend.
Yeah.
So, crazy. I mean, that's crazy. That's crazy. He couldn't play anything at all. Like, I'm not saying, I mean, I definitely can't sing. I should never
Blood
be allowed.
Blood curdling.
It's gnarly, embarrassing.
But you still thought you'd join a band.
It was my duty to do so.
Make it onto an edit, though. You played Save Harrow Day, and it was on the Save Harrow edit.
Fucking hell, that was embarrassing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I was in it then, that's good. I was already out of it by then.
Was that also the same lineup that played the UKSA thing? Where you smashed the effigy of a rollerblader.
Yeah, no, that was one
of old men looking fucking terrified.
That was one of our best gigs.
Yeah,
The fans weren't very happy about it.
They were not.
No.
Yeah, that was a good one.
But Steak that you're talking about is still making music, and he's in a band called Meansteed, and he's got a song on Into the Void.
Adam Moss.
Fucking good song. Adam Moss's section.
Such a good combo, them two.
Really nice board of talking about Adam Moss. Like, what a graphic that is. Who designed that one, Nick?
That was French. Yeah.
I think it's all things from, like, Cornwall, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Do they have zombies sunbathing on the beach in Calow?
have you not seen them? No, they've moved to Margate.
That's you. that's you, that is.
Super. Yeah, those are all things like...
there's your tea.
If you look it up.
Oh, man, I need some more tea, actually.
Yeah, more tea. There you are, sir.
More tea, sir.
Yeah.
Don't you worry about that.
Right, you're right. Some tea coming up, brother.
Want tea as well?
Yes, please.
There we are, tea for Ron.
Is there any Stella tea?
What's that? Spare tea?
Stella tea.
Do you want any special teas,
sir? No, I think you might have to go on to this super cool manly tea, actually.
That's alright.
Is that alright? Can I have a super cool manly tea?
Do you want one of these teas?
Yeah. If you put it in one of these, you feel better about yourself. So let me just crack these up here. While you tell me roughly...
What I was saying about the videos was, when we were making the video, we'd listen to songs that we had with sections to try them out, and when you put the right song to a section, something kind of clicks, and you're like, fuck, that's the one.
You know.
But it was even more so this time, in the sense that, I don't know if I really made it clear, but loads of weird stuff was really happening in the section, and the song lyrics would match up, and that's before we edited it. It was not clever editing. It was just on there.
We were like, this is looking quite good. This tune we've got, we haven't used this tune yet. It kind of fits the pace of this guy's skating. Let's just try it out. So we'd just play back the timeline with the song on, and then, yeah, someone had grind a bench, and the song said something like, on the bench, and it was like...
And then on Eddie's section, the Brandy song...
Watch out the way.
And it says, get out of the way, and there's a woman in the way and stuff.
Yeah, and we were just like laughing, like, no way. And then when we did Dan's bit, we had an original song that didn't really fit in the end, or it was too short, or whatever it was, we weren't going to use it. And we just chucked this other song on, and it goes into this mad slow-mo bit where we'd previously slow-moed Dan on the glass board, like, or the perspex, the clear board in his bowl. He does like a calf grind, front side and back side. And we'd already had it in slow-mo, and the song just went into a really weird slow bit on there, and we'd send it to Dan Ruff, and Dan messaged back, like, oh man, it's amazing how you've like re-edited it to be all slow. And we're like, no, I haven't touched it yet. Yeah, we just put it on, and it's just sometimes like... We were just laughing.
Sometimes.
So you don't do any of the editing, you just oversee, but you kind of offset that to Mark and Toby editing and doing the videos and stuff.
Yeah, those guys know what they're doing, and I go along and kind of get in the way, basically.
Well, it sounds like you're a busy man. You've got many different things. I'm talking and I'm coming up with things that I want to go all over the place. I want to talk about Richie Jackson and Melcher. Yeah. I want to talk about but we're trying to stay on some kind of, you know, a nice arc story timeline.
We can talk about them dudes, if you want to talk about them.
Well, what I want to do first is I want to go back, actually, to... What year did I lose the house comp and cry? I think it was, 2002. Yeah, see, this is what happened, right? I told everyone at school I was going to win the house comp, and I was 12, and I came, and I lost. But because there was no internet, there was no one
who
was going to... So I went... Yeah, obviously,
you did.
The tears went away. Monday came, and I won the house comp. So there you go. Until someone found out that I didn't. But anyway, Josh, Holdsworth was so very, very good, Josh Holdsworth. And I used to just, I just tell people he didn't exist. Like, oh, I heard a guy called Josh Holdsworth. No, he didn't exist, so anyway. But I did win as a consolation stop crying prize, focal point.
Lucky you.
There you go. Which was where I became properly kind of introduced to two men by the name of Mark Nicolson and Dan Case. So we have both of those sections here. So I thought you could give us some.
Wow.
And I distinctly remember watching both over and over and over again.
Yeah, I was on that video too, wasn't I?
And Ron was on that video as well. So there you go.
Danny,
you and
Passmore.
I think Passmore loads of everybody's on, but I always remember the intro where you are just changing
outfits. Or the styles, yeah.
So I don't know, it's going to be a bit of a... Oh, there we are. Let's see if Noel can work there.
Shut up.
Yep. There he is.
There's the bowl.
Is that green or yellow?
The bullshit bowl.
Painted in green screen.
I'd pay a grand for that.
Look at those Mike Carrolls, Vans Mike Carroll. What?
It was Mike Carroll on Vans, I knew that.
Shoe was come out and for a few weeks, and that was it.
Down on
Oh, that bay button.
That's the same.
Made in it.
Wait a minute, you've reused them clips, haven't you?
Hold on. This is his part, and like I said, I've recently gone through the old tapes.
I see. You've got his back.
This will all come out eventually, because I think I might even have the focal point tapes, because it was Ian Passmore's video.
Yeah.
But he didn't know how to edit. He came to me and he said, "Mark, can you help me edit this video?" And I basically. He would come around to my house at the weekend, stay over on a Friday, we'd stay all weekend, and just edit it at my mum and dad's house. He'd stay like on the floor, like on the sofa or something.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, because he really paid attention, he went on to make Hello Coco, which was Passmore's second video, and he completely edited that himself. And
was that a kid?
Brilliant story about that. Brilliant story about that.
Check this out. Basically, right,
that's something I've never forgotten.
That's the best thing that I've ever done, right? by a mile.
Why wasn't that last trick?
It was like basically a freak accident. I was ever able to do it. I was so pleased with myself, right?
Say clearly.
It's filmed on high 8 tape. I just watched it and watched it.
Well,
I don't think it
snapped,
but it
didn't last
that long.
Well, basically, when we captured the tape, it was like so glitching that we kind of had to kind of like capture it like a bunch of times, and sometimes there'd be one frame that didn't glitch and we could piece it together a bit.
Why wasn't that your ender? Down the old kinky handrails.
Spencey editor.
Mark must have decided.
Ian Passmore edited it.
Well, he can tell us all about your fine work now. Let's keep on rolling down the old time machine here.
Oh yeah, is this my section?
I think you look, well, strange enough, a bit younger in this
pioneer.
One.
That's Pioneer.
That's Pioneer. Who's that healthy young man? There he is.
Oh, God. Look, having the best time.
How old are you here? I really, really, this is giving me a flashback.
What
year is this?
Well, roughly 2000.
Is it?
So I'd be 19.
Switch front side flip, Ollie the
12. Remember, yeah.
Push, Ollie.
Oh, it's like a Baker video.
Passmore, the thing with Passmore, right, is a lot of people would describe his filming as like aggressive, or he'd go, oh, come on, you've got to do it and that, but for some reason, I've got on so well with Passmore that when we skated, like, we would always come back with something good. Like, almost like his annoying thing was what I needed to hear.
That's,
you know what I mean? You would sort of say, like, oh, it's quite difficult. Yeah. But for me, it was like exactly.
Yeah.
So I'd meet up with Passmore and he had a good camera, like, or he'd use my camera, like.
And what I like about this is what a lot of people would say is not allowed in skate videos now is your skate parks, which.
I've never subscribed to that. I think if it's rad, it's rad.
If it's a good trick, yeah.
Doesn't matter where it is.
See, I would say you were known for that. One of your tricks you were known for, Monitor, and the old 360 nolly. But I don't seem to distinctly remember those kind of
going
around.
Yeah, that's the one.
There he is.
I was in Slam one day, and they...
Oh, what is that place? There it is.
Represent.
I was telling them about trying to get them to order the video. I was like, oh, this is a new video. And they're like... Because Passport's basically got...
I thought he had his whole section. Is that all he's got?
No. Because we made the video, he had a bit in my bit. That was the deal.
Yeah, they're going, the guy put himself in the video. Like, yeah, he's a bit of a self-promoter.
Yourself in there.
Yeah, you're going to order it. It's like, what?
That was before Instagram. Instagram now, it's, you know, there's no rules, is there? Self-promotion is great now.
That's what it is. That's life now.
Well, it's like all the people that were like, oh, don't do it like that. Like, I mean...
Reminds me of the blueprint video, that spot. I think. Jensen spot.
Get you switch heel.
The old switch front side flip.
Red Lambs, that was. No, that's a clip. We already see that, didn't we? That was off that place. That footage did us well, didn't it?
Yeah.
That one guy got us that free video.
End
you got like your section.
You definitely had two front side flip masters with Ronnie doing the regular front side flips distinctly, and Mark doing the switch front side flips. Okay, we want to talk this again. We were going through when we obviously prepped for the shows, and we were like, kind of look. You know, you talk about an avenue you're going to go down with death and what you guys have done. Where do you even start? Like, we were looking at team members, and after a couple of hours, I thought, okay, we're still going here. So what? If they go somewhere else, because there are so many, and I find it almost a little bit ironic with you saying earlier it was supposed to be a bit of a spoof company that 21 years later. Do you know how many pro death riders or how many death team riders you've had?
No
idea.
I can't remember.
Where do you draw the line,
folks?
Because then got even Death Urophane seems to have its own thing. Yeah, so an example would be Sean Curry, who gets the wheels for the team to ride the brook.
Brilliant.
See Sean tomorrow.
Oh, hopefully.
Yeah.
I just try and carry on and hold it all together. I can't really remember a lot of the finer details. I'm sorry, but yeah, there's been a lot of riders, but. There's been some riders that have been around for 20 years as well.
Yeah.
It's like the Titanic, but still floating.
Right. Okay. So you've
while we're on that subject, we just did the 20 years of death show at House of Vans.
Yeah.
And well, Horsey, but and yes. myself and Chris Johnson, me and Chris Johnson basically curated it.
Yep.
So we had to, for weeks beforehand, we were going through all these emails from multiple, like dozens of photographers have had shots from you know, random people back in the
day. Thank you, by the way, to you guys and the photographers. Like, they must have dug through some old stuff.
Yeah, basically. We couldn't get a photo of J.R. Neves in the end, I don't think. And there's a couple that were... we're missing. We had to really dig deep to you know, think about it, like, you know, who was going to be in it and stuff like that. And then a lot of some, particularly the contributing photographers who sent their actual slides and never got them back. You know, a lot of the stuff was, it could have been even more insane than it was. As it was, it filled the entire gallery and the back room.
That doesn't surprise me in the slightest,
It wasn't like...
And that was just some of it, wasn't it? That was just a little bit of it.
Honestly, it could have just gone on and on and on. It was insane. Like,
have you kept a good kind of magazine and product itinerary of the last 21 years? Or 21 years ago, did you make boards thinking... Because obviously now, I'm assuming if you could, you'd go back and every board you printed. But when you're making them, you just...
I haven't got all of them. I got quite a lot, but I haven't got all of them. And the same with the magazines. I haven't got it all. But I've got a fair bit of history.
I've probably got all the magazines just about.
Oh, probably. What?
Well, everything you've ever been in?
Well, yeah, like, what is that?
Well, I've probably got most of the things that most of us have been in.
I've got everything
I've ever been in, yeah.
Right. Awful lot of magazines. Do you know how many...
Yeah, boxes of them, yeah, it's a curse.
Do you know how many pro Kate's boards there are? Because they...
Someone asked me that the other day, but maybe 30, I don't know.
The Kates is a cunt board has got to be one of the... why did you... Hey, look!
That wasn't a
pro
board.
It was an AM board, wasn't it?
There's a story there.
It's like the sticker thing saying Death Skateboards and it wasn't Death Skateboards.
Exactly, yeah.
He had a board and it wasn't a pro board.
Can you have a board and it's not a pro...
Dex did it with Ken Sigurfish.
It says you were a...
They just take the piss out of him, though, weren't they?
Is it a pro board if you've been called...
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Basically, this is what happened, right? So we were in the house one Friday night.
Yeah.
And we were fucking around. You just set up a board or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
He's a
fresh board.
Like he can't.
Oh, I can't do
he's
anything.
Terrible at staying on board.
I'll tell about everything. Yeah.
No, not everything.
You can use a fax machine, can't you? Leave him alone.
No,
he's got some skills.
Really good at some stuff. Well, quite a lot of stuff. Like probably more stuff than I am. But you can't do a DIY.
No.
And you're really bad at doing grip tape. I mean, that's fair, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. So he'd just done this. Grip this board and we're sort of like taking the piss and that, right? And then there was like some like labels, wasn't there? Like a roll of just blank, you know, like those paper self-adhesive labels. So I got one and I wrote, Nick is fat.
No, you were, I am fat. I think it was.
Yeah, so it's on the top of his board.
Which is true.
I think I remember.
Were you there?
It was, I think so. And
I am fat.
No, but it was like death was written a certain way and you like coloured in the D and the H.
That's probably another time.
Oh, yeah, that's another time.
So anyway, I get a lot of abuse.
It said, I am fat or Nick is fat on the top of his board, right? And then, what did you do? Did you write Kate's is a cunt on my board?
No, I said to you, oh, right, I'm going to bring out a board that says Kate's is a cunt on it then.
Oh, yeah, and I was like, yeah, that's so sick. And definitely. Are you really?
And he was all hyped on it. I was just messing about and he was all stoked on it. So I thought, oh, fuck it, I'll do it then. So I did it.
And there it is, Kate. Yeah. So this is way back in the day. That's not a pro board, is it?
Yeah, but basically, that's just sort of like a joke, yeah? Mm-hmm. There's only like 50 of them made.
Yeah.
And, well, I think there was 50 of them. I've got a feeling.
5,000.
They all sold.
Yeah, and it was something like it was. Yeah, anyway, right. Yeah, I got like saying, like, in the end, I got. You gave me a royalty on them, but it was like way less than normal. It's like. 50,
what was it?
It's like 50p a board or something. But I think you paid
back
me...
Back then, you could buy a lot. You could buy a pint for that.
I could, yeah. But I think you paid me for 100 when it was only 50.
Oh, did I?
That's nice.
Yeah, but I mean, you're taking the piss anyway, a 50p boy.
Well, don't write on my fucking group chat. Yeah.
Anyway, right, so this board comes out, and then everyone's like, oh my God, you're pro. Like, fucking hell, I can't believe you're
so
pro.
Is that your, is that,
no, was
that
it?
So again, we fucking rock, we roll with it.
So
it's
just like, I wasn't like going to go pro or anything
was
like
anybody
that.
Pro at
barely skate.
Was anyone pro at that point?
I don't think so.
No.
So
Kate's,
I think it was just, I made some boards and I was in the house skating and I made some boards. It was really just like...
At what point do you go, all right, you know what, Nicholson's pretty rad, Ronnie's pretty rad, I'm going to write your name. There's got to be that moment where you think, okay, that's...
It was just organic. It was organic. It just kind of gradually happened and we were like, oh, this would be sick to make some boards, some pro boards. And well, it was literally just, oh, let's do this. There was no rhyme or reason. It just... sort of happened naturally.
But, I mean, you needed some pros, didn't you? You got to the point where you sort of going along and...
An ambassador of the old brand here.
And I wanted to see my friends' names on the boards.
Yeah. There's a really cool thing, and I won't try and quote on a serious note, and it's on the front. Well, actually, going back even a step further, House Rob showed me this incredible website. What's it called? Where you go back in time?
It's
called... Red Cube. Oh, this way.
Internet Time Machine.
Internet Time Machine. And everything all good there. What we put... yeah, no idea. We'll just let on and all that. Don't know what's going on, but yeah.
I'm just going to
Internet Time Machine. You can put in a website.
Just blaze.
And it will take you back to whatever year.
Yeah, it's cool, isn't it?
So we were going back 2004, 2006, 2008, and we were looking back at all the current boards, which is amazing because you can see an up-to-date team, an up-to-date itinerary of all the products that you guys were selling and stuff, which is really, really rad. So we could see all these. Do you remember, like, for example, ones that we've forgotten was the holographic... white
Ronnie and Danny,
black.
Ronnie and Danny boards,
Holographic boards, like stuff that you can't remember. Just the one that just says "fuck" in massive letters, you know, stuff like that, which is really rad. So if you want to go back in your own time machine, get on that website, and you can see all the old death stuff because they have 21 years of it. A lot of it's hard
I can't even remember half of it.
There you go. So there was
the handprint boards that.
There was a story. There's a story behind that. Okay, so there was this really sick art exhibition, and I think Grip Tech Thumb Pin was a lot to do. I went down with Foz and a couple of others.
Penzance.
It was really rad, and they built all these obstacles, and they made the side of the inside of the building like a pool. It looked like a pool with tiles, the coping, the lot. It was really sick. And everyone, all these really sick artists had done all these boards for it, and there was two spare, a black one and a white one, and they were like, Nick, do you want to do some artwork? And I was like, I can't do artwork. And I remembered on Red Dwarf when he had to do, when Rimmer had to do an exam, he'd written all the answers on his arm and he went like that to look at the answers, to lift his sleeve up, and he rubbed it all out by mistake. And he went like that, slapped his palm on the exam paper, signed it and fainted. So I used that idea and I just got my hand and put it in paint and put it on the two boards.
Graphic, yeah.
And then I thought, I'll just do it as a graphic. And then I got two graphics out of it as well. So it worked out pretty good. Thanks, Red Dwarf.
Can I just tell you a quick story?
You can tell me whatever you want.
This is testament to how good they were, right?
Yeah.
So I went for an interview to get into art school. Mm-hmm. And I took those boards with me and said that I'd done them.
Fantastic. It's not too similar to lying about winning a skate con, really, so I feel for you.
They let me in,
What's it think?
And I did 4 years of uni and I got a first.
Well, there you go. There you are. So, thank you.
It's
a
pleasure.
There was two boards
on Rimmer.
There was two boards in there that I never remember seeing, and they kind of like stuck out amongst all the other ones. They were yellow. There was a yellow one and a blue one, and they were like diagonal.
There was a green.
Oh, they were terrible. I did those.
Did you?
Yeah.
They themselves shit.
Yeah, there we are. You know, we're all going in deep there.
Oh, sorry.
You can't win them all.
Apologies.
They were just, but now I remember so many kind of, I cut this, the kind of hazard Kate's board. It was like a, you know, like a.
Yeah, just like the symbol. I like a lot of those kind of.
Yeah, there was an alligator in a bin. For Ron coming out of a bin.
Yeah, that was. We're going to bring that one back out for Ronnie. I really like that. That was Swampy that did that.
Yeah.
I really like that graphic.
There
in the wheelie bin.
We're just reminiscing now.
You did that again.
The downward spiral.
Yeah, but it was a square.
Downward spiral.
Yeah, downward spiral.
That's really good.
Which kind of.
I've still got the t-shirt. Blackwell, wasn't it?
Still got the t-shirt.
Yeah, yeah, Blackwell board.
It was a Blackwell board. Yeah, Blackwell, that was just. Yeah. I just drew a spiral and thought, I like it, so we did it as a board.
So before we go too far into the late 2000s, I want to take a brief stop off at Squadrophenia, which is a real there we are, if you don't mind, little pit stop.
Yeah.
And tell me if I'm wrong here, and I hope I'm right, but I could be, but am I right in thinking that it's one of the highest selling British skateboard DVDs?
No.
Definitely.
I mean, yeah.
Did it not? I heard that it just shifted a whole bunch of copies.
It did all right.
Copies,
but, no, there's no way that it would have done would, some like some of the other DVDs. That
I heard it was
in the UK. It sold more than Lost and Found, but
I don't think so.
It was a lot cheaper.
But does it? You know, if
I tell you what,
well, that means that the word then, Rob, did you tell me you were shifting a lot?
Yeah, we couldn't keep them in. We were flying out constantly.
There was so much swearing for a fiver.
Are you picking that up on? Is it? Can you say it louder?
Yeah, we can hear it.
They were a magnificent product. Yeah. We couldn't get enough of them.
I'll tell you what, right? Whatever the sales were, and I'd say it did good for a bedroom skate company.
Yeah.
I think it's a really good video.
Yeah, no, it's great.
These guys did a really good job on it.
It's very different. It's not your ordinary.
There's so much footage, really archive footage to put together in there.
It wasn't technically a death video, was it? So many of us rode for death that are on the video, but it was a death squad video. Like the first death video, you know, you mentioned earlier, the VHS one, that was Death Squad the movie. And that was it pre-death or just as you were starting to make the boards? There were boards in the video, aren't there? Yeah.
I think it was just before about the same time. Basically, we were a crew, we were the Harrow crew.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the Death Squad.
So you just started to do, because it's totally, you know, different to the way it looks and the way it feels, totally different kind of, but a lot of people speak very highly of this film, media, whatever you want to call it.
The Death Squad, it was Chris Wolfe, Nick, Ginger Steve, J-Bone, Kate, and Martin Herrick.
Yep.
And Death Skateboards was...
Okay, right.
Obviously, Dan, like... It crossed over.
Me and Dan were involved in both, so it kind of got confusing and people thought it was the same thing.
Yeah, I don't think,
The Death Squad come before Death Skateboards.
We were just named the Death Squad, weren't we?
Yeah, someone was taking... Like again, Zorlac? Someone was taking the piss out of us and said, oh, the Death Squad are real.
I don't know if it's me or you or... We just saw, we'll just go with
that.
We're with the Death Squad now.
Basically, if someone ever takes a piss out of you, just go along with it.
And
you'll be doing it for 21 years.
Yeah, it's work.
Or don't.
Yeah. Actually, don't.
Well, we're going to, we've played a lot of trio footage. We've played you guys. I think we should have a look at some...
The gaffer.
The gaffer, the boss man, the El Capitan on Squad Drafinia, which is that's a little part here. Delicious. Very vicious pull-outs of both of them.
That's
right.
With the dreads.
Very vicious.
But the way, you know, there's no messing around yanking out of them. Is that the original house?
That's the current one.
Is it?
Yeah, still there.
But that wall behind him, where you see it's like magnolia there, it's like brown now.
Yeah. Look at paint time. That's another very iconic death graphic, actually, the one you got there, was it supposed to look like almost the Calow?
Just coincidence. Complete coincidence.
Yes.
Does it look like that?
No.
So
Amsterdam. Blue Banks, Amsterdam.
That was your Christian bank, wasn't it?
When you're editing South of France, I'm assuming you pick the songs for the most of the guys. What about for Nick, who's like the captain? Does he pick his own tunes?
What? Lay it back for
there
him.
There it is. That'll do it.
It's not very Zorlac, is it?
When Schizophrenia happened, Dan had a very clear idea of what he wanted to do.
Yeah.
And basically, every time I was like, right, this footage is all together, what are we going to do with this? He'd be like, it's this tune or this tune, I've already thought about it. Like, Dan had all the tapes labelled down to like a fifth, 43 minutes, Smith Graham, lying in the car park, such a big job. It was a massive job. But afterwards, basically Dan made it as easy as it could have been, and it was still gnarly.
Look at that, getting tech with the freaky front side flip.
Oh, look at that! Get that track in there!
There it is.
Oh, that spot was amazing. That was the North Circular Ditch, that spot was amazing. And that Harlow ramp before was just incredible. That ramp was so good. Dead cat ball.
Follow your heart and trust your instincts.
Happened
for a reason.
Yeah. There he is. Nice.
But I'll tell you another thing.
Nice work.
When we had all this, obviously it was all on tape then, so it's like 100 or more DV tapes, which was just about 3 years' work.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so paranoid about losing them, because obviously you lose them, you've got nothing. So I bought this fireproof lockable safe for all the tapes to go in. Yeah,
so and that, you kept them in there, the vault.
Yeah, the vault, yeah, we had a vault.
Have you still got that?
Yeah.
And all the tapes?
Got all the tapes, yeah.
Oh my God. So, you have to go through them, the raw footage of those days.
Very professional, a lot of things.
Very, very much so. What's the criteria? Because again, we're going to at some point kind of go through all different kind of members you've had on, but if we keep it kind of the guys that we know are hipsy, Moggins, even Johnny McNay used to ride for you guys, get boarding back in the day. What's your criteria if you're looking for a death team member? Because I guess before this, Matt, what I was going to say was at the front of your website, you've got a really nice about us. It's like a written blurb,
yeah.
Which I don't know if you want to kind of say. Okay, so basically, what it says.
Do you know it off by heart?
Yeah, a poem.
I've revised it.
It was pretty cool. Yeah.
What is it then?
You're not going to ask me the year again, are you?
Another cup of tea,
what,
please.
Can I have one?
I don't want to steal
the. I bought 10 thinking, well, some of them are doing harm with me.
I could do another tea.
Well, yeah. Oh, no, we've got three. We're doing all right here.
Styler crate.
Cup of tea for you, sir?
I'm alright, I've got some beer, thank you.
When they run out, we just have to have real tea.
There we are.
Oh, thank you very much.
Reality.
You can't let
so basically, what I would say is there is and there has been some fucking incredible skateboarders on the team.
Yeah.
There's been some shit ones as well.
that is kind of.
And this is what I'm getting to. So basically, how I'd put it is that if someone has got something about them which kind of feels like it's the essence of what skateboarding is to me,
yeah,
that I really like that.
Yeah.
So it's not just about technical ability.
Yeah.
No.
But like, so this is a good one because if someone said to me, I mean, well, firstly, right, what rider over the years is the most death? Hopefully not me, right?
Yeah.
So is there one that stands out? Do you know what I'm saying? Is the most what it is, embodies it? Who is that? Is there one?
No.
It's a mixture of
a good question.
Yeah.
I always think
is it one for you?
I always kind of think Horsey is really what it is. Like someone who's like.
But he's back now, and I'm fucking over the moon.
Yeah.
But there's a flaw with that because he quit.
Yeah.
So that doesn't make him the most.
Sucks, yeah.
Because
I'm so psyched
he's back.
This is on my down the timeline list because it was like you would tap that first, you'd tap that later. But because it's only just happened, it's at the end of the new video. You got a little bit on there.
There was one that was the most deadliest.
Yeah, okay, so
of course it is.
There we are.
You don't need to ask.
But Horsey, who was super rad, yeah, and he had
that's good, Dan. Well done. That's
the,
good.
That tease.
Is that Earl Grey? That's not Earl Grey, is it? Don't give him Earl Grey. You'll go mad.
So, Horsey was on for ages and ages. He used to live in the.
He lived in the garage.
He lived in the garage, yes. Do you know that he used to. He used to just always think I was Manhead, and he'd just message me, be like, yo, I don't know, you must have had me saved for Manhead. And he talked. And when he'd say, yeah, he just thought, oh, Manhead. And Manhead's a good looking guy, I guess. I take that as a compliment.
Did you go with it, though?
Well, no, because, I mean, this is the awkward
bit.
Did you
text him back, like, yo, Horsey, it's Manhead?
I think it happened in I think it got to the point because. I was a bit younger and I was like, you know, you're like grommy kid that's trying to be like, oh, death team guy.
Maybe you said you won a comp that man.
It's just taking credit. So I think the whole time he'd met me, I thought, oh, I've made friends with Horsey here. And apparently, you know, 6 months later when he stood up and he was like, oh, wait, man, Ed, I thought something horribly going wrong here. It's not me. So yeah.
Just enjoy being Leonard.
Yeah, he's a good guy. But you gave him, I could be wrong here, his pro board, was it a pink? Did it have pink on it? His pro board that he had?
With the horse on it.
Right, yeah, with the horse on it, obviously. It was a really, really awesome graphic. But then he was gone not too long afterwards, right?
It happens, you know. It happens. I was really upset when he went, but these things happen.
I cried.
There it is.
Wow.
And where did he... I could be wrong here, but did he quit to... Like, because he kind of...
I think he wanted to move to America and he rode for Todd's...
brand. What was the first one called? High Five, was it?
Yeah, that makes sense now. That rings a bell.
And, you know, he wanted to do his, what he was doing. And good luck to him. And he did it in a nice way. He called me up properly. Didn't.
Yeah.
You know, he just quit in a sort of, in a nice way.
In an appropriate way.
Yeah, he called me up and he was really cool about it. And I was gutted, but, you know, these things happen. It's not the end of the world.
He'd gotten Supra. And he was like,
yeah, wow, this is all
he was got. He got on a mad flow sort of thing through Supra, but yeah. I think, as far as I was aware, trying to remember, they weren't going to mess with like a Euro team at the time. They were just like, if we're hooking you up, you're on. So they were like, come to America now, and he was over there a lot. And I think it just got to the point of the new crew he was with in America a lot were just, it was like harder and harder to like kind of.
Well, he was with really gnarly people, but. What a lot of people don't know is that he had his own colourway shoe ready to go, and it had on the insole it had the Essex swords.
Yeah, the triple sword.
And it said his name on the heel.
Yeah.
But and he's got the samples. I've held the sample in my hand.
But it didn't work, for
but it didn't come out.
No, because I think they just changed their mind.
No thanks. Tried that. So. What was the gap, like 8 years? More?
It was a long time.
Yeah.
No, something like that. More. Yeah.
And then what, he comes back to London, gives you a call?
Ever since he quit.
Things just haven't been the same.
Ever since he quit, you could tell that he missed being with the crew and his friend, you know, his friends here. And
yeah.
I guess it was fine when he was in America, but then when he was back, he was like, because we're all mates with him, and it was like, even though we were all quite sad when he left, it was still like, fair enough, mate, if you're going to be able to go to America, if you can make it your job, and you can make some money, we're backing you. Like,
he had an opportunity.
It's sad, we don't want you to leave. I won't ever admit that I wanted you to leave, but you did.
Yeah.
And, you know, because go for it. And we all sort of like, sort of, not sort of, you know, not really wanting to, but, well, no, we were basically like, look, trying to be as nice as possible, but like, just go for it, like, just.
We wouldn't
have
wanted to deprive him of.
There was no sort of like, you're a dick or nothing. Yeah. It was like, oh man, like.
We're gutted.
Yeah, we're gutted, but it was like, anyone you'd know that had the chance to go and do something mental, it's like, I wouldn't ever say to someone, you shouldn't do that or anything.
I feel bad if they didn't. If they got the chance to ride for some huge company.
Yeah.
And they didn't go, I'd feel really guilty. You know, I've got, I haven't got a huge amount of money.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a lot of commitment to people. I've got a lot of loyalty for people, but I haven't got loads of money to chuck about, unfortunately. So I'd never tell people to, I'd feel bad if they didn't take the money.
Yeah. Which I do think, by the way, is a common kind of like, no one who will ever heard kind of that thing you just said, which is extremely loyal to the team members. And it's always seen from everybody that I've never known, or I've known a fair share of guys that rode for death over the years, that it is very family orientated. You are a team, you are all extremely.
Both ways.
With yourself and your riders. And I'm assuming that's what you look for. Like you said, it's not just about what trick you do. If you're a complete wanker, then it doesn't really matter, you're not coming to play ball.
It's kind of like,
I want you to get on with it. You're not going to play ball.
I think, Dan, do you remember
that? You're a complete wanker.
We remember.
He's on my list, Scott Borne.
Scott Borne.
He's on my list,
I think me and Dan remember when there was, we sort of talked about it before, but we remember when there was nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's something about what we do that's like, we don't care if there is nothing to gain from it. We're just fucking doing this because that's all we've got, really.
Yeah.
And it's what we know. It's what we love.
Skateboarding, right? That's why we're doing this. That's why you guys do what you do.
Yeah.
It comes down to it.
I just think when Scott Borne got on that was major. That was pretty heavy, actually. Yeah, and it was, well, at first, it was when he came over, it was really rad.
We had a big name American pro when a company out of a house in Harrow.
He knew how to do it. Like he would go to work.
Is there a but to this? I'm waiting for the but.
He kind of tried to, and I'd say it to him if he was here, but he kind of tried to take over a little bit.
Okay.
And he wanted me to change the name and get rid of the UK riders and stuff. And I was like, no, I'm not doing that, mate.
What did he want you to change the name to?
Death UF. So Death USA.
See ya!
Thanks for coming. You wanted to change your born and bred British skateboard company to Death USA.
Yeah.
Don't ask, you don't get.
And he wanted to me to get rid of the UK riders and not fire down.
He's a liability.
I was like, look, that's just not what I'm about. I can't do that.
Yeah.
And you know, he may have had in his mind some good reasons or whatever for that, but I wasn't going to do that.
Yeah.
And he started his own brand really soon after, anyway.
Okay, so kind of came
and
went.
Kind of lucky I didn't do it.
Like I say, I had some good times with Scott. Like, yeah, he helped us make the bowl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, he lived at the house for like a while, and yeah, I mean, he was, it was like really good to just watch how he did things, and I mean, he wasn't a normal person. He was like quite an exciting person.
He was a really driven person, wasn't he?
How did Horsey end up coming back then? So you're just chatting and you just, and he's just like, can we, you know?
I think he decided to stay, that he was staying in England and he wasn't going to move to America. And I think he just missed out. He felt like he was missing out on hanging out with everyone and having something to skate for and work towards, even if it wasn't necessarily making money.
Yep.
Just being part of something and just keep on doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
And I think he decided he's going to stay in England now, not move to America. And I think he just thought, you know what? I just want to be back with my friends again and doing this.
Does he skate full time still, or is he working elsewhere? What does Horsey do? I don't really know much about him.
He skates really good.
Is he ride for Super still?
No, Vans. No. Yeah. Oh, no, he works at the House of Vans, and I think that.
With Rob.
Rob, yeah.
Dog, the dogger himself. There you go. There's so many.
And them guys and everyone at the House of Vans for the last premiere.
Yeah.
My God, they hooked it up.
They really
hooked it up.
Best.
Just
night.
Insane.
Drad, was it?
We had nearly 800 people there.
Yeah. 800 people?
Nearly, yeah. It's over 750 people, yeah.
Yeah, that's no joke. That's a premiere.
I think they said something like they had some Metallica thing like a couple of weeks previous and it was something like 650 or 700.
So you've done really well. I think that just speaks to kind of the volumes of what death really means.
It's obvious that we're better than Metallica, though.
Yeah. Duh, you know what I mean, yeah. So, is he pro again now? Is Horsey pro, or is he just back on the team? Or
my understanding is, once you've turned pro, you're pro. That's it, isn't it? As far as I understand, until you retire. But he hasn't got a board out at the moment. But I'm down for, you know.
Do you mind asking? Do they get royalties? Do you pay the guys?
Yeah,
how
they
does
get
it work if you're a pro for death.
£1.50 per board.
Unless you ever case as a cunt board, you only get 50 pence.
You lucky didn't get a fucking dry set, mate.
So they got £1.50. Do you know who the highest? I'm assuming it's probably Pritchard, or maybe it might even be. I would guess maybe Richie Jackson, but the highest selling name on for death skateboards over the years.
It's
or has he had that many that he just has to be Kate's because
he's in the right place at the right time.
Yeah,
they all sell pretty similar.
Really?
Yeah, pretty similar.
And do you have a highest selling graphic ever?
Yes, the original graphic that's been
this one.
Yeah, 21 years, never changed it. Which is pretty mad because I don't think there's many companies that have.
For a spoof company you were trying to do, you've certainly been around a while. It's a long joke, mate, 21 years, if it is.
If I tried to do something good, I'm sure it wouldn't work. It's a mystery.
Do you mind if. Go for it, Dan.
I was just going to say, how many different sizes of that board are there now?
About like 15 or something.
Yeah, and you do the reverse as well with the white and the black.
That's like a
poor
one.
Why not?
Are you getting the cruiser shape back in?
If you want.
Yeah, I want one of those.
Do you mind if we touch on something that is very, very serious? It has only just happened this week, and I did debate whether I was going to bring it up. I think if it's all right with you guys, I wanted to have a very small chat about Ben, just because I know you'd had a kind of dealings with him earlier on. If that's all right with you guys, like, just in the spirit of everything that he was kind of known for, which is just being rad, but I'm right in thinking that you had a handling in going to the States, is that right? That kind of started that journey that you went on to become a very, very well-known professional skateboarder.
I absolutely can't take credit for that.
Okay.
But he did, I did get him hooked up with Consolidated, and I had the pleasure of going to America with him and Ollie Timon, Stiley, Richie Jackson, and we were based in Consolidated in Santa Cruz, and we stayed there every night, and we rented a car and went out every day skating, and it was just the best trip. It's just incredible, and I still quote him to this day from that trip. It's
I think it's hit everyone so hard because he was just such an innocent, lovely, beautiful human being. And yeah. There's not that many, to say the least, people about that are that nice, just genuinely nice. And that's why it's got everyone, because he would just... It just seems so unjust that the nicest kid. Why does it have to happen to the nicest kid?
Yeah, I don't think I ever heard one single.
Is he unique?
Just there isn't. Like, yeah. Just unbelievable.
Everyone in the world who met him loved him.
Yeah,
and it has destroyed me.
Yeah.
He's unspoiled by the things that change you as you grow up. He's kept his. I don't know what you if you want to call it childlike innocence, whatever you want to call it. He's kept it.
Yeah.
Or, you know, and I think that's, you know, it's a quality that virtually nobody else has when they're an adult.
I think the reaction has been, you know, of what you see, the, in fact, was it to do with yourself? The what do you call it? The page for donations for the thing.
GoFundMe.
Yeah, sorry, the GoFundMe page, which absolutely.
It wasn't me, no, I just reposted it. I saw you reposted it. To try and it help type
it. Speaks for itself how much. I think it went 1,000% over what they were.
Just that really. For. The lad that did that really hooked it up, amazing. Just the reaction to that, it just shows you how well loved Ben was.
Yeah, and did you see the amazing thing that Rob did in the what do you call it, like the bowl on the water? I don't know what you would refer to.
The cradle,
like,
sort of
the cradle thing.
Yeah. We were lucky enough to have Ben as a guest on one of our big pushes.
That's 2007, right? 2007?
I'm not sure.
Right.
Yeah, it sounds about right. It's, about watching the clip back, he definitely looks like a young lad. So yeah, much respect to Ben there. Moving on, two guys. So I've got three lots of two that I always associate with each other. One is Melcher and Jackson. Another one is Pritchard and Dayton. But first I want to say, and one was one of my favourites for a while, and he came out of nowhere and he seemed to disappear back into nowhere. Boots, who was, man was good on a skateboard.
He could skate.
Maybe I should start with this guy second, but he's also a lot of fun. I still got him on the old Facebook and do keep up with his non-skateboarding life. Good. Ben Cundall was another name who's I always kind of...
He was a good skater, but even, I mean, he's, you know, he's really good, but he's even better at being a disappointment.
It was. I was finding it weird because he rode for Nike shoes and he rode.
Yeah, he had it all.
Yeah, he was doing it all.
That's when I was over it.
Yeah, you were over there. Was that it?
I'm not on that side. But.
So he was. He had a part on one of the old the ordinary. Oh, I don't know which one that would have been.
Was it? No, it was. Escape from Boredom.
Yeah.
Distinctly remember him doing the backside. Go on.
Transworld.
Yeah, so, I was going to say that. Yeah.
The Transworld did a review and mentioned him specifically. Yeah. He was a really good skater. He just got into like partying and all that stuff too much.
We were in the van once and he was, we were like, sort of like, really going at him for like not skating and stuff because he was like kind of drifting away. Sort of thing. And he's going, yeah, well, you know, when Transworld reviewed the video, they mentioned my part. And I was like, yeah, well, you don't even skate anymore, so what good is that? Sort of thing. But
It's a shame.
Yeah, he was a lot of fun. I loved hanging out with Ben.
Yeah.
And if I see him now, you know, it's even though he wears like this skin tight jacket.
What's that about? Skin tight clothes?
It's like, last time I saw him, he had this suede motorbike jacket. It was like two sizes too small. And he looked like Negan from The Walking Dead. You know, he wears that motorbike jacket.
Yeah.
He just needed the bat with the barbed wire, basically.
Yeah, I see. So.
But yeah, I mean, I'll let that slide, but.
Yeah,
the,
but the Nike shoes were.
But what I'm saying, Ben, I've not forgotten all the good times, and it was fun. I'm sorry that you took a different path, and I mean.
He was motivated for a while. He was really motivated.
He was value for money, wasn't he?
Yeah, it was great.
A lot of fun.
It was great, and it just faded out. It happened.
Yeah.
And in Boots was Harrow local.
How good? What's his real name?
Paul Hopkins.
Paul Hopkins. Just call him Boots, shall we? Cause that's all right.
Much better, isn't it?
From cover of... Document?
Inside.
Double down somewhere down the Manchester Hubber.
Backside nose blunt.
Oh my God,
What? I remember.
And did it like fourth grade, didn't he, or something?
But it, when it... I mean, nothing to take away from that. We were... we were blown away. But the fact that he did it and everyone was there as well, that was...
It was
and
it was just
and made it, didn't
and
it?
I think everyone had like 2 hours sleep because there was a party.
Oh, we slept on the floor. We went to a house party. I convinced this girl. What were we there for anyway? Was there like
we were there so that you could.
No, Rob Smith's turning pro party.
Yeah, it was Rob Smith.
So we had Rob Smith's turning pro party at the Central Skate Park, and then it was like an after day, went there. I think it was sponsored by, it was, because James Root was there. So it was a Monster.
Kicked
down some money. Because Rob was on Monster at the time.
Yeah, Monster Europe.
So it's like a club, isn't it, in Manchester?
Yeah, and we'd had a few drinks. I've got loads of photos of it with him, with his trousers down and all the rest of it, and he usually does. And then we slept on the... So I convinced this girl to have a house party, and she wasn't having it, and I was just like continually, we can have a house party at your house. And eventually, we did have a house party at your house.
Excellent. So this has paid off, yeah.
And we've been in the building for like 1 minute. And we went in her I don't know whether it's student house or just like rented house. It's quite a big house. We were all there, weren't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, anyway. So we went in the kitchen and she had one of those, is it CO2? It's the powder one.
The dust.
Yeah. One of those fire extinguishers on the wall.
Yeah.
And you know, like people are like, kind of like, well, normally, but you just kind of like, you just sort of play with it and pretend to let it off.
Right, yeah.
Because we're pissed.
Yeah.
She had a serving hatch.
We?
Sanchez was pissed.
Yeah,
picked up the fire. It just happened.
We'll get back there eventually.
Yeah, this is pretty.
It's just a warm up.
Right, I'm with you now, Mark.
Pretty backside nose blunt.
Yeah.
So she had this.
Like about 7 hours before the nose blunt.
This serving hatch. Yeah. So I just got, like, no, Matty got it. Like, Steak got it off the wall.
Yeah.
And I got it. I said, took it off him. I said, I'll show you what to do with that. Point it through the serving hatch and just let it off in this girl's face.
No. Like, you let it off, right? And she come over to the serving hatch and started screaming and shouting, quite rightly, what are you doing? And you turned round and pointed it in her face and she was like, what? And it just comes
in.
It was a gas. She looked like a ghost.
You know where she had her eyes shut like that? Yeah, it was like two rings of pink and then she's just completely white.
So you convinced her to have a house party and thanked her for having the house party by spraying her own fire extinguisher in her face.
Well, yeah, that's the least I could do.
Yeah.
But like in this room, it's, you know in Weird Science where she makes it snow in the room?
Mm-hmm.
Did she make it snow? Whatever she does, right? It was like that, yeah? It was snowing in the lounge. Yeah, and everybody, every single person in the party ran out like...
Everyone was coughing and
stuff. Yeah, like unable to breathe.
Everything
and
was
it's just
dying.
Me
the
and,
fire extinguisher. It puts just, out fires, yeah.
Yeah, it's just me and Matty in the kitchen and we're just laughing. Yeah. And so I just got the fire extinguisher and said, what are you laughing at? And just blasted him as well. And he had the same. And then they said, we got to go. But we had been thrown out in under 2 minutes. It's like a new record. I was like really happy
even
with
you,
that.
Even for you.
How did you manage to turn an incredible backside nose blunt front cover story into you?
Into that?
You terrorised a young girl who had an house party by...
Oh, yeah.
It's like the back nose blunt was good, but
let me tell you a real story.
I mean, it's kind of out of order. So, I mean...
A little bit,
I'm really sorry. Yeah, it was... Yeah, it's kind of lame to be honest, so I'm a bit sorry about that, but...
A bit.
Don't be too sorry.
She probably, like,
horrible
talks
person.
About it in
yeah,
the same
like,
vein
yeah.
now, probably.
But looking for you,
to a therapist.
But what the point... the point I'm making is we got thrown out in under 2 minutes, so that takes some beating. That's good, isn't it?
Well, I mean...
That is very good. So,
get thrown out of a party within 2 minutes, takes 6 years to make a video. I don't know, we got it all confused.
But Horsey nicked her bike.
Oh, no.
I mean, that's worse, isn't it, really? Lame. So, I mean, that's just how it went down.
Mark, can you
tell... And then Boots down a nose blunt.
And that was very good.
That was wicked.
He was, like... He was talking that... I remember he had his first light, which was like... Was it a front blunt, front board, dance kind of hobby? He had the sidewalk cover, he had the document cover, and he was... He reminded me, and some people hate him, Chris Cole. I think he's rad, but he's got such a solid kind of...
Yeah.
I don't know what it is, he was just solid on board.
Yeah.
I rang him, maybe you'll know this, Dan doesn't know this part of the
did
story.
Did he think you were manhead at the time?
He didn't think I was manhead. But wait, do you remember, it must be, what, 7 years ago? You came and met me in Mile End and we did that
piece. Yeah, that was fun.
Well, I rang Boots first and he told me they didn't skate anymore, so I called you and then you came and did it, so...
Oh.
Was that me? No, what happened is I got both of your numbers. This is what happened. I got sent both of your numbers. I couldn't get through to you, and so I don't know if I'd rang you for his number. Maybe Ronnie gave me his number.
Right.
But I rang him, and I was like, you know.
To be fair, he would have been better at it.
Yeah, but all he said to me was, I was like, you know, be really great if you want to come do this clip. And he was just like, oh yeah, just don't skate anymore. And I was just like. Oh, this is a real.
When he skated, he had this focus when he skated. Yeah. It was just gnarly. You could just see he was so focused.
And he just.
And he was having it, you know.
It just. All he wanted
the ground would shake. Like when he would jump down some stairs, it's like there might be three or four people sessioning some stairs, and it's like, as people do, just flinging off them or sticking it or whatever. When it was boots go, the ground went boom when he landed. Like he had this mad technique as well when he was jumping off anything big. He kind of like. When he kicked the board away, he would kind of turn. Backside, so like, don't need to like mess up everything.
You think, man?
But like,
get your groove on.
His technique of bailing the board was he would land like this. Like, say he was traveling this direction. Say he was
can
jumping.
Can you do
this,
that again?
Right, there it is. But like, do you know what I mean? Like, say like you jump downstairs and you're like, oh fucking hell, and you just try not to like eat shit. Like, he would kind of have this technique of going off something higher. He would turn slightly backside, take it all in his legs like that, and then kind of
just roll backwards.
He had a really strange like. Well, it's just the way to do it, I guess. Of like. Kicking the board away wasn't a thing. He could jump off something massive, kick it away, land, nearly flipping break the paving slabs, but just do that like
just
30 or 40 times, like fine.
Machine. And really, from your point of view, I suppose, I know it's all about, you know, the friendship and the fun to you guys, but there's got to be a point where you go, great, got a top guy here, repping a death board, you know, he was that good that he could have probably got on a plane and gone over. And he just, did he call you on this to say, look, did he get married or did he have a did he become a family man? Is that kind of happened? He just said, I've had enough of this.
He moved away, didn't he? He moved away and at the same time just kind of faded out and just didn't. I think he just didn't want to be. He just wanted to retire and not be a sponsor. Didn't want that responsibility. Or
you know,
pressure.
Respect everyone's opinion, but it's odd to get that high. You know, usually guys that retire or step away, they haven't. Not that it matters what point you've got to, but when you are getting front covers of both front covers of magazines. The hard work's almost, obviously there's still hard work to come, but you've got to a certain level, you've done some serious stuff to get there, and then you just say, yeah, I don't think I'm doing this for me anymore, it just seems... Yeah.
But he was on Adidas and things like that, like he was really like, I think he was getting paid like from a few things, like,
Oakley,
I mean, I don't know.
And stuff, yeah.
But yeah, he was up
was
there
it,
in the like...
He seemed to be an overnight, didn't he?
He wasn't just getting free stuff, he was up there in the group of people that are getting money
did
and
you
stuff.
Did you know for
I can't,
a while, just
I really speak. I can't really speak for him
yeah.
in terms of why he did that. But he just didn't seem interested. He skates a little bit, and it was really nice. He came, he sort of paid us a surprise visit.
Yeah,
one
that
of
was
our
amazing.
20-year parties last year. He turned up to the Broadstairs one, just unannounced.
I bet
he was
he
so
can
stoked.
Still skate, can't he? I bet he's one of them. He just give him a board, and he'll just accidentally kick.
Well, he was like, oh, I've got a board, and that. It's like he's like, I've been skating a little bit, and I think. Because he has kids, does he have kids?
Yeah.
So
he's a family man.
And I distinctly remember the alloy clip with the car, where you drive and leaves the
With Tim Westwood playing.
Yeah.
It's some mad tune.
Yeah, that's a gnarly part as well. Like,
yeah.
Oh God.
I know. It's almost like we're selfish, aren't we, skateboarders? Because we're like, oh, can you come back skating again so we can watch you do ridiculous stuff?
I can't do that
anymore. So will you please? But I just remember being so good, and yeah, just thought it wouldn't be, you know, a death episode and not mention a lot of these guys which have
absolutely
been so shockingly stable.
And it was nice because he said to me, at one point he said to me, oh, thanks. He said I probably wouldn't still be skating because first of all I gave him cheap boards when he was a Harrow local and he started getting good. I gave him cheap boards first and then put him on the team eventually. But he came up to me and said, oh, thanks, if it wasn't for them cheap boards, I don't think I could have afforded to keep skating.
No way.
So it's nice that he said that to me. And Richie thanked me as well after one of the premieres, the one before,
mm-hmm.
He took me aside and said, look, when you showed an interest in my skating when I met him in Australia all those years ago because we were his first sponsor, he said, when you showed an interest in me, something clicked in my head, in my brain, and I was like, right, I'm having this. And he said, he probably wouldn't be where he is now and wouldn't have done all the stuff he's done if I hadn't have showed that interest. And
that's amazing. It's got to make you feel great as a, you know.
Oh, it was so nice of him to tell me that. Yeah,
he was. Yeah. I'm definitely. We are going to talk about the nutters that are pitching date and all that. But let's go forward a little bit and chat about the pirate of skateboarding himself, Mr. Richie Jackson, who is. Yeah. Am I right in saying? I got this wrong earlier with the DVD. I was nearly right though. Is he one of, if not the most watched clip? Yeah. On Thrasher? Is that like 10 million?
So close, yeah.
10 million views or 10 million?
It's either the top one or second. That, but it's, yeah, 8 or 9, 8.5, 9 million views.
With a death, rocking the death skateboard.
It?
Yeah.
Thanks, Richard. Section was called Death Skateboards, I think. It was Richard Jackson Death Skateboard.
It was supposed to be the section for Into the Void, and he was done so long before everyone else. He released it, and it was great.
Yeah, he's.
So thanks, Richie.
Absolutely. So you meet him in Australia. Was he doing the Shiver Me Timbers thing back then and all the cool like stuff? No, he wasn't doing any of that. Because now he's so and I love what he's doing on, you know, he's got such a style and he stands out amongst everybody else. Hey, Bill, look at him. You can't tell with Richard Pryor. Richie doesn't have
Richard Pryor.
A pirate thing about him. I'm not having anybody saying to me, what are you talking about? The guy's super rad. He absolutely is a man, but he's got a very distinct style.
What's that? I'd like to think Musketeer.
Yeah, I suppose
it
more. Yeah,
but is he Porthos, Athos, or Aramis?
Which one?
Or
what?
D'Artagnan.
What is he saying?
The Musketeers.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, definitely Aramis.
I only know the Three Musketeers when it was the animated version with the mice, so I don't know too much about
the
that.
Dogs,
but I know
dogs.
Dogs.
D'Artagnan.
I don't know anything about
it. D'Artagnan.
D'Artagnan.
Richard Jackson's rad, that aspect's crazy. It must be amazing from your point of view.
It's great. Yeah,
to see that. How much of a difference when you went overseas to kind of to the States, didn't call your company Death USA, but went over there anyway, you got Melcher and got those guys on board. What's it like having that whole thing
Death
going over
USA.
The States?
Well, I met Richie in Australia.
Yeah.
And when I met him, he didn't look quite like he does now, but he was definitely had his own style. I met him and Schooner. I just thought they were really cool and I liked their skating and stuff. I mean, in terms of, we don't really have huge distribution in the States or anything like that at the moment. We sell bits and bobs to Japan and a little bit in America and here and there, but it's really UK.
He seems 90%. Very loyal to you, like.
He is.
Yeah. I could only assume that he could kind of be doing whatever.
He's had other, offers.
Yeah, that wouldn't surprise me, just how like.
And the loyalty works both ways, again.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Yeah, he's great.
And Melcher as well. Again, maybe I've just this in my mind, but I always kind of place those.
Melcher's amazing, but can I just say one thing?
Say like whatever
when
you like.
Nick was saying, thank you.
Anything. say it all.
Nick, you were saying about, you know, how he thanked you.
Idiot,
after the last premiere? Or?
It was the one before. It was.
Oh, okay. But I mean, he
Ordinary Madness.
Sort of regularly says things like that. And not this past time when we had the 20 years of death, he was over for that, the 20 years of death.
You guys all
but
came
like the time before, he was like, said to me, he said, you know, oh man, I've got to say thank you so much because we put him at the end of Squadrophenia and that's the first video that he'd been in.
Right.
I guess that was after, Yeah, so that was after Nick had...
after I met him in Australia, yeah.
After
and he filmed for that.
After Jeremy Fox here had spotted the talent in the Southern Hemisphere. Our friend J-Bone, who's living in Sydney, he came back to England and he had he busted out his laptop and he said, let me show you what I've got of this guy. And it was basically his Squadrophenia parts.
Yeah,
like I said,
blown away.
There's no question that we'll have that.
Yeah,
put it in.
Yeah, he's a very special kind of.
Well, he was in like the pole jam phase of the feature because he goes through phases of like he gets an idea about a certain way of doing a trick or a certain approach to something, and he will just rinse it basically for every possible version. And you've seen him doing the like power slides into tail slides. And it's like he will find something and it like. A scientist or something that finds like, oh, this is an interesting thing no one's done. He doesn't just do one of them, he will try and complete that area. So like that, the Squadrophenia part was pole jam time. So if you watch it now thinking that, it's like,
pole jam, pole jam, pole jam, pole jam 180, switch pole jam, switch, you know, pole jam down to stairs, pole jam grab, pole jam to manual, I don't know, but.
One of my personal favourite things about him is that he isn't, he can skate, he do nollie trays, and tray flip, he doesn't just do all the, you know, the quirky kind of stuff.
Amazing.
He'll do a firecracker on a tenser and you'll be like, oh, he just tray flipped out of the bottom of it, which so just really adds that, you know, for the guys that like the tech side, the guy can just do it all.
We've talked about this before, but that's the key to his tricks, isn't it? Like his flat ground game. He just trains a trick.
Yeah.
And then they'll train it switch. You know, so, yeah, he's got that control. He's good.
What shoes does he ride? I've completely gone blank. What shoes does he ride for now?
He was riding for Servant. I don't know if he still is or not. He was riding for Servant.
Amazing.
From Sweden.
And Melcher?
Melcher was psyched on Richie.
Yep.
And I was liked Melcher, and I thought it was amazing that he had that section. When he got let go from Black Label or whatever happened with Black Label, when he didn't have a board company sponsor, he still had a section came out on some video, and it was incredible. And I was like, I thought that was really sick that he still had this really sick section coming out, even though he didn't have a board sponsor, and he was still just having it.
Mm-hmm.
I always remembered that. And then he wanted to get on because he really liked Richie, I think.
Yeah.
And I think he was a bit like, what's this sort of odd British company?
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, let's have it. Yeah.
And still, so how long? So have they been riding for you for the same amount of time now, both?
No, Richie was on for a bit longer.
Okay.
I guess it's about, what is it, about 15 years for Richie and about 12 years for Melcher, or about 14 years and 12 years, or something like that.
He certainly does seem it was only recently put up a post kind of thanking you guys. He's obviously very appreciative of the opportunity and stayed loyal to you guys when, you know, I saw a lot of people in the States as well, when they do get that name or they appear on the Thrasher site and on Skateline and stuff, and the other offers come in. So, yeah, it's awesome to see those guys kind of flying the death flag over there.
But, I mean, when you meet Melch, he's just he is the best guy ever.
Rad guy.
Yeah.
He's very funny.
I love him. And also, he's he's into, like, British stuff, a bit like, say, someone like Matt Hensley is. He's got a Vespa and stuff, hasn't he?
Yeah.
And he's got Irish roots.
It kind of works, doesn't it? It works.
British.
Yeah. But he is, I can't speak highly enough of Melch. I love him to death.
To those guys.
Wish you got to see him a bit more often.
Yeah.
Somehow. More parties, man.
Somehow.
Convince
like
more ladies you don't know to have more parties, and then we can invite all the guys along, and we can
if they haven't got a fire extinguisher, who knows, we could be in there for maybe at least 5 minutes.
10 minutes, 5 minutes, away. Yeah. All right, let's talk about...
I've got to go to the Kazi, I'm sorry. Excuse me, I've got to go to the Kazi. The toilet. Excuse me, sorry.
He's coming back.
You'll be alright
for a minute.
I'll be alright with
that. Don't forget your mic's on.
Rob's coming.
Okay.
We're still going.
With one person missing.
He can pop on back. I've not seen Rogan show.
Ronnie, come
and
cover.
This is death. We can just see how it goes.
Hey, Ronnie, do you want to sit down? Do you want to take my place for a minute, Ronnie?
I'm okay.
Right, let's talk about Nick. Yeah, go for this.
Yeah, well, while he's not here. What's it like? We'll carry on while he's not here. What's it like, skating, being a part of, what's he like as a boss while he's not here? Do tell. There's your time to either get horrible or get
terrible.
Nice. Yeah?
No.
Yeah, he's a good boss, yeah.
You don't
want to
hear about
what he
said about him.
Oh, you work for him now?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say, I did 12 years. So I've survived.
Doing?
I did the invoices, the goods in, the goods out, the picking, shipping.
Yeah. And what do you do now?
I'm just like packing the boxes now and stuff. Like I pack the boxes at the at the house. So like when the shops make orders, I put it. So if you order anything and it turns up wrong, it's because I got it wrong.
Who lives in the house at the minute?
Felix and his missus and that's it at the moment.
Is he not as crazy as it has been then over the years?
No, it's very mellow now.
Yeah. Horsey, one time you've been there, you've had the BMXer, you've escaped. Yeah, you got, where are you now? You're in Margate, right?
Yeah. I took refuge in Margate.
Yeah, you're over in Margate.
He's got a girlfriend.
No, more than a girlfriend. A wife. He's wifed up.
No, he's got a wedding ring.
Talk to me about, and you can fill in this when we get back. Talk to me about Pritchard and Dainton. So
let's do that. That's what we want to get into. Yeah.
Do you want to just go? I mean, do you want me to? Huh? How do you want to go? How do you want to approach this, Mr. Gates?
Well, I mean,
how tight are you guys?
He's the tightest.
Yeah, is he?
Well, because I was in Pritchard versus Dainton.
Yes.
So we've got a bit of a bond.
Yeah.
And I knew them prior to death.
Yep.
And prior to fame.
Yep.
You know, and I've also, well, Nick as well, as we've always gone to Wales a lot.
Yep.
And then I went even more so when we were filming Pritchard versus Dainton.
Yep.
And like I say, there's a bit of a bond there from that.
Yep.
And I've done other stuff prior to that, like we skated from Cardiff to Newquay to raise money for cancer one time.
That's awesome.
Just things like that, and they're the two of them have got. I mean, if you ever see anything with Pritchard, he's just got the most incredible personality.
Yeah.
He's just someone you want to be around, and Dane as well. You know, they're just, you want to be around them, and also they're this type of people where, say you haven't seen them for a year. Mm-hmm. You'll meet up with them and it'd be like you've seen them every day.
Yeah, no, there's not been a gap.
That's how it is, you know. We've got.
Do they still?
We've got stuff to talk
are
about.
Are they like death? Like they team riders? Like, are they nothing to do with death? If they're going to go skating, like, I always associate them still with death skateboards, or is that not?
Well, they're both retired.
Yes,
they're retired, but.
Oh no! Obviously, you can't expect to see a new part from either of them on the videos. But you know,
it's not that they quit and they retired or stopped skating. They rode for death, and then they didn't want to be sponsored.
Okay.
Not by death, but it was like, you know, like it was like a nice place for them to, like, basically, if Dainton or Pritch films a clip, we'll put it in what we're next doing, because it's like for example, we were talking about boots earlier. Mm-hmm. He's like started rolling around again, and I'm sure when his kids start skating, like, because it's kind of in the blood, isn't it?
Yeah.
But perhaps, maybe not. But if he's, you know, if he starts skating like a little bit again, and he goes somewhere to a skate park or something, films a bit, like, you know, we're not afraid of a skate park clip.
Absolutely.
But we can get the homies in
especially. Not afraid of skate park clips. Too much hate on the skate park clip stuff.
It's like,
if it's rad, it's rad.
It's
yeah.
really expensive to travel places and film clips in other countries and
pay for
filmers and photographers. It's like, it doesn't happen just like at the fingers. Like when it's just a couple of idiots going out with my dad's video camera, like it was in the early days.
It's fun to watch.
Like, that's how we did it.
And also, some things aren't possible, like car deals 360 at Marseille. Mm-hmm. That, where else are you going to do that?
For sure. So if they get a clip, it's always kind of, like you're saying, they've retired and not pro anymore, but they're still very much.
It's a family thing that's so powerful that goes beyond like that.
Can you take me back in times to what, 2000 maybe 3 or 4? So you guys, because they both got pro, Dane's got pro board. They both had pro board. You had a pro board. You guys are pro. Everybody's pro. How does this thing happen?
Everybody's pro.
You know, these huge stars. And the main question I have for you is, being so closely affiliated with them both, when the Dirty Sanchez 4, if you will, came about, were you ever mentioned as being one of the guys that could potentially have been involved in that, or was it never anything you wanted to do, or did it just, was it just?
Yeah, well, when they had the initial meeting stroke interview with MTV, that Pritch and Dane and Dykey came back to our house. Do you remember? It's the night we were up all night, they were jousting with those car seats that were in the lounge. Yeah, all the light bulbs are broken.
As you do.
So remember, Stu's girlfriend came out of the. His bedroom in the morning, all like obviously had no sleep because we'd just raised hell all night, and she just stepped on a broken light bulb and just cut all her feet. I mean, it was just
so many female injuries in this.
It was his, yeah. I mean, yes, this,
that house was such a state.
It's not a safe place.
No. That old house was such a state. You wouldn't know if there'd been a party there the night before or not, because it was just like that the whole time.
Wow,
it's great.
I tried to clean up.
I'm sure you did.
Yeah. But, yeah. I mean, what were we saying? Sorry.
Ever looked to be a part of.
Yeah, so basically, there was talk of them trying to take everyone who was in the video into the show, and obviously that wasn't going to work. And then, you know, when it became apparent that they were going to get this show, and when the show actually came out, and they're all naked all the time, and like it's virtually homoerotic.
It got pretty hectic.
I was just like, well, I mean, I couldn't do any. I can't do that stuff. Like, I'm normal.
That was a them four thing.
I can't do that. So, you know, there was no animosity. It was, you know, I was just the same as anyone else who skates. Just so stoked for them. You know, like some of our own are now.
It must
famous.
Have been insane because, like, again,
it was amazing.
From us, they were like, we didn't. No, for me, sorry, being over here, didn't know those guys apart from seeing them in the magazine. So there was no kind of like. You know, when you're a kid, it's all, everyone's a superhero that's a pro skater, so it was just kind of, they seemed, and, but for you guys, you were just skating with them every day, and you were a bunch of teammates, and all of a sudden, you turn on MTV, well, at the height of the Jackass era, which they became the, you know, that kind of level. You guys must have, you know, they were known, and still are, known all over, but their peak, they had films out, they were hugely grossing sales of DVDs, and you guys, they're Death Riders, so it's...
It was amazing. Yeah, it was amazing.
But what sucks is, we've been on... I mean, in the early days, before even Death, we did a trip with Pritch, didn't we?
To Amsterdam.
Oh, we did a couple, didn't we?
Yeah, it's great.
What about the one in the Sierra?
Oh my God, yeah, we rented a rent-a-wreck place, a Sierra.
Yeah.
And the bloke didn't tell us that it had remolded tyres on it, and we were fast laying on the motorway in the rain, and the tyres blew out.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
it was
and
gnarly.
It was me, Racer Pace and Pritch.
That was
in
a
back.
Great trip.
And there's you and Kingy in the front.
Yeah.
And the car was just, Reese was driving.
Yeah, it wouldn't
and
steer.
And he was like, I can't control the car,
There's all lorries flying past
and inside. And I had this hoodie on, and I just put the hood up and pulled the strings and just went...
Goodbye.
And that,
that'll be it, Dan Kate.
But we're still alive, so it's all right.
That was a great trip,
So you're still in touch with those guys? Obviously, you are yourself. They're doing a comeback. There's a guy...
there's a comeback.
It seems to have...
not a comeback, but like just a... Q&A.
Yeah, they've all kind of come back together. They're going to show the film and kind of. Yeah. I mean, how long can you get naked and gnarly for? I mean, can you do that for, like, you know, they're not the same age as the.
How long have you got?
Yeah.
I suppose when you get to a certain age, it turns into something else, and then there's probably a bigger audience. Once you're like 60, you can.
Yeah.
You think it's more of an audience then?
Well, I mean, I don't know if there's many 60 year olds like. Doing that sort of
circus, like someone will come and watch that, the freak show kind of thing.
Like, it might be
but now it's kind of amazing if you look back at what, you know, a couple of skateboarders managed to.
Cool. You'd even be away somewhere and you turn on the telly and they'd be on the telly.
Yeah.
Which is brilliant.
Yeah, really.
The thing was, is like having, because I didn't really know him that well, like, and obviously it was like Pritch and Dayton, and it's like, oh my God, because Pritchard from like his skating career was like. I grew up watching Pritchard.
I guess you're like me saying that they were like the same, that, you know.
Man, skating Milton Keynes and all that stuff, Pritchard back in the old videos, like.
He was on, what was. Was
Panic. Panic,
yeah. He was on Panic, wasn't he?
Yeah. But like.
Which is crazy to me,
just
yeah.
Just shredding, and he had the bleached blonde hair and the combats and the wife beater, and he had just like.
Signature combats.
Really?
Yeah.
What draws it? What was it?
Howie's one, I think. Yeah. But he's
just sick to watch and to just go like, oh, this guy's like, you know. On like my teammate now almost.
Yep.
You know,
of course you were
and it was trippy because I admit I was like, whoa.
Yeah, and then they are doing all.
And he's like, yo, Mark, what's up? And I'm like, all right.
He became full-fledged celebrities. Like, do you know what I mean? Like those guys They used to go all around Europe, and so it wasn't. It didn't just contain to.
They were big in South America.
Yeah.
They were the most successful show that MTV had ever had. In Europe.
That doesn't surprise me at all. Like that, you know. Remember the DVDs and everything just flying out of the film and everything.
And the thing was, like, say there'd be, for example, like times like when it was like, say we'd done a demo or something. There was some Death thing, and that, at the time when they're all skating, all the time with us, like, well, they'd be around. There'd be points where we'd be all back at the house, and there wasn't a camera out. There wasn't anything going down,
and they're fucking
with us, and they're doing something, or Dank's doing something to Pritch, or he's like, Pritch has gone to the toilet, right, you follow me, we're going to do this thing, and it wasn't even filmed, it was like, so all of that madness that they filmed and ended up turning into all that stuff, that was just their life,
they were
like that, and it was dodgy.
They were that fucked.
They kind of exposed, I love Jackass, they did was amazing, but... There was, Jackass is so gnarly, and then Dirty Sanchez came along and were like, yeah, watch this, my friends. Like, I think what you guys are up to is pretty gnarly. You know, they went to, you know, one was kind of like entertainment, it was a bit characterised. Then there was just four dudes that were just absolutely going to war with each other. Like,
the paintball one was amazing, wasn't it, when they told him he was going to be on the Guinness Book of World Records.
and they took it all, took like 100 yeah. shots of the paintball, and they just made it up. Yeah.
Bit of a sore point to this day, I think.
Oh, really? Oh, shit.
But, I was thinking, you know that one where he's like, he's somewhere and he's got all this shit in his eyes and he's trying to wash his eyes in the sink, and whilst he's doing it, Dayton's putting more washing up liquid in the sink, and some person's like, no, 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 and he's like, shh. It's like
washing up powder, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, and all this, and then Pritchard's washing, and he's going, oh, it's getting worse.
Yeah, I remember that one. Here you go. Yeah. So, God. Could not talk about those guys.
Good
and,
times.
Brilliant. Joyce, like, films, he's a filmer as well, right? So
I've known Joyce for years and years. Just,
and obviously.
He lived in Harrow for a bit. I think he went to college or something. Him and Justin had a place, didn't they?
He did film, he did. Was a filmer, him, wasn't he? Like,
from back in the day. Yeah, he's doing loads of. He's got all the sick cameras and stuff.
It's like drone cameras and crazy stuff.
He seemed to be the guy that was like they all wanted to be in front of a camera, and he was the one that were like, come on, you're not. And he was like, nah, it's not. And then he just ended up
doing the knowledge.
Yeah. It seemed to be kind of like that. And obviously,
I feel like he wanted to
Pancho
sort of
as well.
Push everything forward. Oh, Pancho, we all knew since back in the day as well, didn't we? Since
super
long time ago. Because, like I said earlier, so many, you'd know everyone in skateboarding.
Yeah.
Pioneer Comp or Northampton.
Pioneer Comp, Northampton Comp, or you'd go to Wales and, you know.
Yeah.
So everyone knew each other.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely one.
Rad. Shout out to the Dirty Sanchez lot. All right, want to talk about Moggins real quick?
Yeah.
Steven.
Yeah, let's do it.
Steve.
Yeah. Oh, Steve. Yeah. Stevie Morris.
Yeah. He's so weird. Well, I know he's not technically from Sheffield, but we got three Stevens, and none of them call themselves Steven. Steve Elvis, his real name Steven. Joe 90, I've only just found out, he's actually called Steven. And Moggins is called Steve, so I don't know why everybody that's called Steve.
Well, where I'm from in Harlow, it's Dan. Everyone.
What are you called, Steven?
No,
you Steve.
No one's called Dan in Harlow. It's the same. It's basically everyone's called Dan, so everyone's got a nickname. There's not a Dan.
Yeah, it's odd, isn't it?
So there's not one Dan because everyone's got a nickname.
Yeah, it's confusing. Yeah, so now we've got the rest. But yeah, Moggins, he's been around for you since forever. I remember his. What was it in document? Wasn't first light? Would you have a document? Omen?
Oh, down there.
Smith. You're right.
Yeah,
on the Aurelio.
Yeah, is it?
Drumfield.
Yeah,
Drumfield, right.
Yeah.
Come on, tell me, what would you get in document? Log. Like your intro thing. Come
first light?
Omens.
No, that. Yeah, Omen, it was Omens, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Smith, now the thing. And that was 2004.
I think Sam Ashley saw the potential in him and he liked it.
That rings a bell, and he had a big Mohican,
Yeah, he recently. Kind of, I suppose, for lack of a better word, retired from being a sponsored skateboarder.
I actually did not even know that. I thought he was. So he doesn't ride for death anymore.
No. But
this is
going to
be his last part, and he had it ready like a long time ago.
He's got some
fantastic section,
and I think it's brilliant.
Moggins was always good. Don't get me wrong; he's always been good. Then about 5 or 6 years ago, I went to a park with him. And he was doing kickflip feeble grinds, and he got another level of good. And I could be wrong here, but I from what I gather, I don't see Moggins all the time when I do. He was just like, he just seems to absolutely love skateboarding.
Yeah.
And he didn't really
just does
need
it
to be
the
pro.
Right
yeah,
reasons,
he didn't,
didn't.
Yeah, he didn't need to be pro. He didn't want that kind of responsibility. Yeah. Saying just was happy.
But he had a. It's great that he went out with, quit being a sponsored skateboarder with such a sick section.
Like he actually retired. A year and a half,
something
2 years
like that.
Ago.
Phone call, thanks very much.
Yeah. So, but his part's still in the video.
It's really good. He's got a great.
But he sort of made it clear that it's like this is going to be my last part. Yeah. I don't really want to do it like
him
have this sort of thing anymore.
Him, obviously, you know Ben Broyd and Dead Dave. No, Dead Dave, big tall shredding Dave. They just get in a car, drive to places that I didn't know existed to skate. Rocks and just
sounds familiar, doesn't it?
Getting on, just so it doesn't matter if they've got a tin of beans and a French baguette to share, then that's cool. That's off them in the wilderness skating a tree for 3 weeks.
Brilliant.
And making it work. That's the wild bit. Guess what clip I want to watch that has you, and Stephen Morris in. Come on.
Is that in the city?
Come on.
Wheel it up.
Yeah. Why did everyone else?
Oh, I got a story about that. So
before or after?
I can't believe it. I nearly rolled that car.
So he's wearing this police suit.
The old Bobby.
And it's like, obviously, Moggins is pretty small, especially here. This is years ago. And this is a real Victorian police suit that I hired from somewhere. So obviously, years ago, people were smaller anyway.
So you fit perfectly.
But it was too small even for
Moggins. You look
great,
Nick.
You'll see him in a minute, obviously.
You couldn't make him not smile on his face, though, could you?
Toby Batchelor filmed and edited this, didn't he? This is, a, you know, I was saying Toby.
Who was that? Was that?
That's me selling.
That's Benny Fairfax.
Benny trying to sell some Benny, watches yeah. to Benny Nugget. Fairfax.
Was Benny just there that day randomly?
Yeah.
No, the British.
Oh, we're basically absolutely. Selling stuff to everybody from Palace. It's ironic.
I absolutely love the get-up you've gone for. It really, yes. Really lost yourself in the. Yeah. I bet you just can't help. Look at him laughing.
I've got to say, they were, good, they were good sports yeah. for going along with it.
Yeah.
So, anyway, yeah, so he, ripped, drop, yeah. he ripped the yeah. arm on that police suit.
Yeah.
And when I took it back, they were like really pissed off because they were going to sell it to a museum. And he'd like just
ruined it.
Luckily, we got it apart.
There's the boarding nice. Question.
Those people at Southgate thought we were really running away from the cops.
Amazing. The old time. Bobby.
Yeah. If you rewind it and watch it, they'd probably have...
So you got the Vans on here. I remember you on a couple of different companies. Vox? You used to skate?
I had 18 years of free shoes.
From?
Which I didn't deserve.
Who you rode for a whole bunch of different people. Vox? I'm trying to think of Vox. Yeah, Vans.
10 years on Vans.
Yeah.
And then...
That was in our house.
Yep, that's...
No, sorry, I'm yeah. to correct you there. It was in the garden.
Yeah, on the yard, yeah. yeah.
it was in the garden.
Yeah, then I had like this really good deal on Vox. I yep. got like 65 pairs a year or something and like...
Were they paying you?
They had like travel and photo
incentive. What about a van? Did you get a good deal with those guys?
No.
Nope.
And
nope, forget them. And then it took you 10 years to realise that.
So basically, my shoe story, it yeah. just gets worse. It gets, so
tell me, I'm down for a terrible story.
It started yeah, with Vans,
yeah.
which you could sell on
yeah.
all day.
Yeah. You know,
it's just to Vox, and I'd have literally, I'd get a package 3 times a year, it had like 25 pairs of shoes in it.
Yeah.
And they were difficult to ship.
Yeah, yeah. Didn't think about skating them now.
Oh, yeah.
One or two pairs.
I couldn't skate in all of them.
I might be going mentally.
Anyway, hang on.
Yeah, so yeah, I'm ready.
Then after that, it was Circa.
Yeah, I was going to say, was it Circa? Because Morgan's had some Circa as well for a while,
which
I think.
At the time, I was quite happy with.
Yeah.
But then after...
Sounds cool, doesn't it?
Finally, it just went to the bottom tier.
You weren't getting that Musker money when you were on...
Osiris.
Yeah. yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So then, when you're on Osiris...
What happened?
I mean, not being sponsored is like... sort of... better.
When Ron was on old 88, did you not get any of them by then? No, you weren't.
But I will say this, right?
Slightly ungrateful.
So
yeah.
That sounds really ungrateful. It sounds really ungrateful.
No, it sounds horrendously ungrateful.
I didn't.
The free shoes I was getting, I'd rather been getting none.
Yeah. But
thanks, Osiris.
You've got to understand that this is like way. This is well after the. Things were good with Osiris, you know.
After Feed the Need as
well. But
after.
I will say that I'm big thanks. Well, thanks to anyone who's given me anything.
Apart from Osiris, yeah.
Well, no, including
Osiris, yeah.
And they took me on the big push.
Yeah.
Which was a very, believe it or not, was an amazing week.
You're trying to save it and you're trying to claw back now, aren't you?
Well, I'm just trying to. Credit where it's due.
it was
an amazing.
You had 18 years of free shoes, and what you're rocking now is it?
I'm just scraps.
Get them now. Yeah.
Just begging for scraps.
You
now.
Need to start getting shoes in so you can hook him up. You had a
shoes, mate.
You had a Death Emmys shoe,
yes,
right?
That's brilliant.
That's wild.
Great. It was amazing. The whole process going up there and designing it with them.
Death
in Warrington and the shoe coming out, and then they ran double page adverts.
Yeah,
just fantastic. Like,
well, who
was on,
it
was a dream.
Who
a dream.
Was on Etnies to kind of do, you know?
It was just more a case of just a collaboration shoe that was just. You know,
you would have thought, like Dan said, with the companies that maybe
Dan,
you guys
were on. Dan was on, I think.
Oh yeah,
Dan,
I was on.
Yeah. Oh, Mark was on.
Yeah, I was getting Etnies for a while.
Yeah, and Death Etnies shoe. I remember the ads for them. They were.
They hooked it up. It was great.
Yeah.
Really good. Good experience.
Double page ad of Zorlac in a real pool.
A Victorian pool.
Well, I was trying to get a pic too, because obviously being on Death and on Etnies and anything I'd sent was like didn't make the cut. So
why?
Sure, I don't know. They just didn't like the pic. I think they wanted something like sideways and
portrait-y
sort of things.
Yeah,
but
kind of shots.
But it just, you know, after a certain thing, and it was like, obviously, like, the pool thing, and it was just perfect. Like,
yeah, yeah.
Next
yeah,
up,
I remember
it was raining as well. I think
and
it was raining.
Distinctly
it,
you can't remember that. Yeah, it's awesome.
It was half full of water and stuff.
And not forgetting the Vox shoe.
Yeah, the Vox shoe, yeah. Yeah, there was a Vox shoe as well.
Yeah.
How do I say it? It wasn't quite as good an experience.
You don't look as excited.
No,
you should have done,
it,
I mean,
it wasn't very
first.
Lucrative.
I don't want to be out of order, but it, yeah, it wasn't quite the same experience. Let's, yeah. Let's, yeah. For a lot of reasons.
But I got the advert for that.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that was something.
Double
so
page.
There you go. Yeah,
Dan wins.
Double page in both mags.
Only
for
because
2 months
we
running.
Brilliant. Only because we haven't done enough Dan Cates. Let's look at some more Dan Cates.
And
no,
that,
because
that wasn't yeah. what I was.
Well, it's
alright
because we got there now. You know what I mean? Like, if there was ever a man that embodied death, obviously, as we've.
Horsey.
As we've. Yeah, yeah. But after that, because obviously he quit, it's Dan Cates. So, give the devil his due, as they say. When he wants to take a good photograph, there ain't much that gets in. Yeah, yeah, exhale. Have we got him up on the old screen here now? Let's have a look. Well, you take. Well, let's have a see what you've got.
All of them.
Yeah, all 50 of them.
In chronological order.
This is a picture.
Well,
yeah, have a skimboard. Yeah, let it ride. Did you? Were they prop bottles or are you smashing real bottles?
Oh,
look, that's not real.
Real ones.
That
yeah.
Is, there's three bottles in it which I bought.
Yeah.
One, that's one of them from their like sugar glass.
Oh wow.
Prop house. Yeah.
Smell it. Really?
Oh
yeah.
Wow. That's material.
You can tell that wasn't made. It's the Ford flipped.
Yeah. That looks like a power slide. I can't tell.
What's that edgy slide called, where you do it on the edge like that?
Yeah, what is that?
Side slide.
Yeah, makes sense.
Is it like front side and back side, both heels or toes?
Wow.
So what's the point of all this?
Yeah.
Oh, it's good fun, it's good fun.
Good
yeah.
Like
suppose,
all
yeah.
of skateboarding. It's all fun. You can keep it fun.
What do you think about this, Nick?
65 years old, that's
great.
Right.
Yeah.
You can probably still do this.
Oh, there's a sticker on there. There's a sticker on there. You showed him.
No, that board.
How many skimboards were injured in the making of this movie?
That board lasted. The song's Breaking, I love the sound of Breaking.
Righty-o, that would make sense.
Yeah. So just to go with that.
That one
smashed. And if you can smash it at the same time, sometimes it's good, isn't it? I mean, we usually smash something.
The baseball with the beer bottles
was good. Oh, yeah, fine.
What about a strimmer?
Oh, strimming, yeah, that was good, right?
Trimming.
People would chuck stuff in, you'd hit it with a strimmer and it would explode.
What's the damage? There he is.
Yeah.
So very proud of that, then, here. Old skim and destroy. So much that you made your own hat.
No, I this exists.
That?
This is real.
Who is that again? Harrow?
Jed, Cullen.
Cullen.
And there it is. What do you call that trick? You got a name?
Don't.
Yeah, it's called the William Tell.
Yep, there it is. Skim and destroy.
Dan, I'm sure you told me something about you were worried he was going to shoot it all the way through into your leg or
well,
something.
It did go through, yeah.
Did you not say he's so pro at it? He was like, if I do it this much.
Yeah, he'll know. Yeah.
Yeah, he wasn't like, oh, I don't know if I do it. It's just like, well, if you want me to do this, then.
You'll be alright.
Yeah, do you want me? I'll just do it. Because he's in Team GB for archery.
So you trust him? If you can't be trusted.
Well, yeah, everybody was like, that was in Southampton. Jed's from Southampton, Churchill's from Southampton, and they were based, Mark and Noah were just like, well, you've got no issues, is that good?
Made for a good ender.
Yeah.
There's a couple of things, but this has been an absolute, adventure. I've learned a whole bunch. We've covered a whole bunch of different topics. I want to talk about our last couple of things. We'll have a look at your covers real quick. Now that Noel, we're going to give them another chance because I think they are very, very, as far as covers go.
Yes.
I mean, that's serious, that. Dan Cates.
That's only a front side grind.
That's probably the cleverest thing I've ever seen you do. And that's pretty damn clever. I like, even the.
There hasn't been many things that I've done which are clever.
That's one of them, though. What's going on here? Do you get in touch first? Because a lot of things you don't know it's going to be the cover, but I'm assuming you're like, I'm doing. That's made. That's. Did you know it was going to be? Did you get in touch with the photographer to kind of say, you know, I want this to be the cover? Or?
Me and Stiley were with, I don't know, with Boots and Horsey and some other people, and we were on a bus going through South London. And he said, have you ever noticed that the pool is like the shape of a snowman?
That was it.
And I was like, okay, yeah, I guess so. He goes, yeah, well, if we paint it as a snowman, we could shoot a really good photo. It's like, yeah, all right, well, we'll do that. And then I phoned him, like, you know how people say that and they just like, so I phoned him up and I held him to it. I said, all right, I'll get the paint, we'll split the paint, and then we'll do it at night, and we've got to do it now, we've got to do it really soon, we're doing like end of September or beginning of October, so,
got time,
you know, because it's only be relevant for a Christmas mag, so, you know, we did it in time.
Really? What, that was a Christmas one?
So you got it
in? So we went down there, night before, we painted it all.
Yeah. In one night, it only took a night?
Yeah. Then obviously we had to leave it to dry.
Yeah.
And hope that nobody fucked it up the next day. Yeah. And then the next night, went down
You left
there. It
the whole day? You left it the whole day?
Yeah.
That is a big risk. That could have been trashed.
Yeah, well, I think people would just say, like, what is this?
I suppose it's probably cold that time of year as well, isn't it?
Yeah, so hopefully maybe no one went down.
Cold,
I suppose a lot of it would have been, I hope it doesn't rain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amazing shot.
That's what happened, so.
And the other one, because that stands out, you know, if you think of sidewalk covers. Obviously this one, which is a chap called Simon...
Simon
Woodstock.
Simon Le Bon.
Yeah, Woodstock, that is an inspiration, or is that...
Yeah, big inspiration. Massive,
And that's another very, very,
and
very...
a good friend of yours too, isn't it? You skate
I'm sort of in touch with him now.
Did you have any other covers apart from the two here?
I think you had
a document one. Is that on the back? Do you have a...
Yeah? But don't worry about
it. We don't have that one.
Don't worry about
it. It's not as good as these ones. I think Ronnie Carl has just gone for a skate there, so... real quick, I think I really want to get your opinion on, with death skateboards being exactly what it has been around. You've been starting this in the 70s, but you've seen skateboarding in all of its forms nearly through the 80s. You started death in the late 90s when skateboarding we didn't have a Tony Hawk's game at the time. You know, you've seen this incredible change where, you know, I used to take my skateboard to school and got kicked out. Now you go to school, they give you a skateboard and you go to a lesson and you learn how to ride a skateboard. Things have changed crazy amounts.
Brilliant.
And but I wanted to ask your opinion on the Olympics, skateboard, GB. I know you've got ties to some of the guys there doing the judging. What do you think of that? Because I think a lot of people, as maybe a side question, there's a big question here, but I think there's a lot of misinterpretation about this skateboard. It's because of the school, because of the name, you know, anybody that knows you guys, it's all good. But I think if you're a parent or you're not too sure, you can see it and think, what is going on here? And so there's a lot there, but can you give me your feedback and all that?
I can understand why people think that. Death, the name, was a nod to the fact that the mainstream media said that skateboarding was dead at the end of the 70s and early 80s. And the skull has been used for thousands of years to ward off evil. So it's not always as it seems. Mm-hmm. And with regards to the Olympics, I think skateboarding will be misrepresented to an extent.
Yep. Do you think the skull could be used to ward off the Olympics?
I think it could. But I think that skateboarding will be, I guess you could say, misrepresented, and I can understand why people don't like that.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, if you look at where a lot of people first saw skateboarding, it might be Back to the Future or the Police Academy film.
Yep.
And that really misrepresents skateboarding.
Yep.
Pretty much as well, doesn't
it?
So what I'm saying is, if it switches kids onto skateboarding and kids get into it and then discover it for themselves, mm-hmm. and it gets more parks built and et cetera,
yep.
I think there's going to be some positives to it as well. So for me, it's a kind of a mixture.
Okay. Dan?
I think similar to what Nick said, really. I mean, you know, we're certainly old enough to remember a time where we had nothing. So, and I mean, don't get me wrong, we had a good time.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you're talking about skateboarding moving forward. We need skate parks, we need facilities, we need stuff for the kids. So, and that's what the awareness of the Olympics brings. So,
But they're not going to tell, worry is that they're not going to tell our skateboarding story. They'll tell their own skateboarding story, and they'll tell it that it's something that we know that it's not. That would be my perspective.
I agree, but when kids look at their Instagram and they start looking at skateboarding,
they'll
discover what they're really into. Yeah.
Okay.
And they'll discover everything else that they're not shown by the Olympics.
I'm kind of the same. Sort
it doesn't really matter, does it, what they portray it as, does it? Because it's just a small slot.
The media always does that.
Mm. I mean, the media always gets it wrong, really. So, I mean, hopefully, you know.
Do you think the right team are on board? A lot of them, you've got Lucy there, you've got
some good great skateboarders on the team.
Obviously there's people there that aren't skateboarders, which you again could see the positives that maybe you can see from outside the box. You could see the negatives that why would a guy that, you know, can't do a kick turn be running skateboarding? You can see both sides of it, and you can see why people are falling against.
Who's running it? Sorry, who's not? Who doesn't skate? I don't know about that.
The guy at the top, I believe, James, I think, is the guy at the top.
I don't know, to be honest.
He's not a skateboarder, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. You know,
you got Lucy.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I couldn't really praise her highly enough.
Yeah, again, I would tend to hear good things. So I think she's right at the top, isn't she? The chair,
She'd be a good person to have on here.
Well, yes,
she's amazing.
We don't like to say who's coming up just in case anything changes, but I think we're going to have Lucy sitting down. Doing a girls episode and centering about girls skating and everything they're doing is definitely important. So we are working on doing that, and Lucy is someone that's willing to, wants to come on, and we want to have on very, very much so. But yeah, she's the chair, and James Hope Gill's the guy at the top that's doing stuff. There's a lot, very, very...
Two rival organisers? There was
the good guys are in.
Yes.
But, I mean, James, I know a little bit,
yep.
and one thing I can say for him is, you know, he listens.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know, it's early stage. It's a strange time,
isn't it?
I'm not going to say anything bad about it. It's only just started.
It's not going anywhere now. It's here now.
Who knows?
It is happening.
Who knows what's going to happen? And if there's Yeah, I don't know.
Ideally, I suppose, of course, ideally it would be better if everyone skated that was on the committee and so on.
Yes. Yeah.
But well, is that going to be possible? I mean,
don't know. Do you have an opinion on where it's going? I just think it's such like a thing in England now, and what's going on, that it's so, especially with you guys being so tenured in skating, to see what your guys' perspective are and if it's different.
The thing is, we do our own thing no matter what happens.
Yeah, yeah. We've seen
it come, all this sort of stuff come and go.
You're still here.
But we're still doing what we do. That's what we're about.
Yeah.
I kind of think it's really sort of like, there's kind of two sides to it, in the way that there are certain skaters now, and no disrespect to them in any way, because they're amazing skaters. Like, there's loads of people that skate really, really well, and they kind of have a sort of sports mentality.
Yeah.
And I don't mean that in a negative way. They're using skateboarding and enjoying skating, loving skating with their friends, but they really do it in a sports way.
Are you talking about things like...
You know, very consistent skaters that can just turn up at a comp and just have a bad day and still win. You know what I mean? There's great people, and there's always been skaters like that in England. That's why I don't think it's too crazy. Like, but the fact that if you're the sort of guy that loves skating comps, loves the competitiveness of trying to do it that way, then, like, this is finally, like, look, this, you can be in the Olympics and represent England, and we'll all cheer on these people. Yeah, I'm not saying I dislike
like
these people.
I must admit, I do think the guys that they've got on board is, you know, a great mix. I find it odd. I was at the, in Manchester with you, and we said to Halford, the champs, that we're not skateboarders anymore, we're athletes now, and, you know, it's not just going skating, you're training. And I think these words that are coming in, there's different kind of, you know, the words you associate, we said last time, where you use, you know, you train to be a diver, you train to be a swimmer, but now you go training to be a skateboarder and you're an athlete, you know. It's all these.
Well, I think that's my second thing about the second thing was that then there's always going to be this side of skateboarding which is like the artistic side. So it is doing something a certain way at a certain spot or or whatever, filming it a certain way, putting an edit together, like Dan's Skim and Destroy thing. That's a work of art. Like, that is kind of both.
Thanks.
It's sick. Like.
Right. He's gonna leave you. There it is.
You know what I mean. It's like there's. But what I mean is, the way that skateboarding has always been, it's generally been photos, video parts, showing up at a comp and doing it live. Yeah. And I think the fact that for a long time it was lame to skate comps. People be like, you're going to skate comp. There were certain companies in England.
Absolutely.
That
there'd
be big comps in England, and not one rider would turn up.
Yeah.
And they were the companies trying to claim being. Like, we run it skateboarding.
Yeah.
And it's like, and then there'd be all this, like, smaller companies, all the dudes, like, we turn up at comps, none of us are going to win a comp in a hurry, do you know what I mean? I mean, back in the day, we had our moments, and Dan, like, could do a massive wall ride, or, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I might get lucky and stay on and
place
or something, but it was never like we were winners or, like, sports, like...
Did you win one?
I won one, yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
There it is,
But you know what I mean? What I'm trying to say is the fact that, not that it's about dividing anyone in any way, but the people that really want to do it in the sports way, they can go for it now because they can represent England and we will be like, yes. And then the people that feel bad about not going to comps can concentrate on their video parts.
Yeah.
It's like you don't have to do both anymore. Mm-hmm. Well, you never did have to do both because it's up to you.
But
you know what I mean?
Same as the X Games has existed for years and, the other end of the spectrum is we can all exist.
Also, I mean, okay, there's a long sort of gearing up to it, but the not to take anything away from the Olympics, but it is, if you want to put it in simple terms, it is just another contest.
Yeah, but it's who's the best, isn't it?
I mean, it's certainly not just another contest if you're somebody that gets a medal. That your life will probably change considerably. Which is a great opportunity. But if you are against it, you don't have to switch on the TV and watch it.
The week after
it's all gone. I was just going to say, we if it's going to turn a load of kids onto skating, and if it's going to get us a load of skate parks, and if the people involved are going to
get a good ride,
then let's do it then, I guess, you know.
There's another thing as well, another point, which is that years ago I've had to have fights with people because I had a skateboard with me. I literally had to have fights with people because I was skated, and I don't want young kids to have to fight people because skate. So if people kind of recognise it and kids don't get hassled for skateboarding because of it, then for me that's probably a good thing.
Yeah, there's certainly an awful lot of positives. Just a very... I didn't think it would ever... I mean, I've not been skating, you know, for probably 10, 15 years less than you guys, but still I've been around for this for 15, 20 years. I just never thought that we'd get to this point. I just didn't... I always thought it would be how it always was, but it's definitely...
You could see it's almost like graffiti. You know what I mean? It's like graffiti... Well, no, obviously not the same. I'm not into graffiti in any way, but I mean, the way it was looked at years ago would have been this thing that sort of like is sort of almost like an antisocial behaviour. Yeah. You know, you can get like, oh, these kids causing trouble, you know what I mean? So like Nick's saying, like, and Dan both, like, if it's going to get to the point where it's kind of legitimising skateboarding in the public eye, then that can only be good for everyone.
Yeah. I mean, you could see it coming, but it's still, now it's almost here, it's still a bit of a shock. It's changing things a little bit, but we'll just have to see how it rides out.
As I said to Alex a couple weeks ago, there's certainly going to be a lot of change in here. I'm just going to go along with it and see what happens, because it's happening no matter what. Have we done it all? What have we missed? I don't want to be accused of missing anything here. So anybody,
how long have we been going for?
A little while.
I noticed that Ben Grove had 45 minutes, right?
I think we might have had longer
There's three of us, that's 2 hours 15 minutes.
You are right, I think we're about there. Anybody? Have we hit it all?
Gloves. I noticed that Ben Grove, and I must say Ben Grove's episode was very good.
Mm-hmm.
That was good.
You did a great job, and he came across as a very nice young man.
That was all Ben, that
we love you, Ben.
But
He had nicer gloves on than you, though.
These are leather. We had leather gloves.
They're very nice.
So, for me,
back in the gloves.
We need to get you another happy tea, don't we, mate? I think it's.
Thanks to you guys and the house for, you know, being there for skateboarding for all these years.
No, that's nothing to do with me. That's House Rob behind there. He doesn't like compliments, though, so don't give him my contact. I don't appreciate that. I do every year at the house. But for something like what we're doing here with the show, like, it's just the same way you guys have done with Def. It was just because we wanted to do some rad stuff for skateboarding. So having you guys down to be a part of that certainly helps. And we just want to, very thankful you guys have come down. We've got all three. Your Ron's over there. Everybody's here. It's 2 a.m. We've had a good time. Did we talk about more? Did we get through everybody?
Absolutely.
I can't remember.
I'm afraid we didn't get through everybody.
No?
Thanks to all the riders, past and present. Thanks to the kids who buy our stuff. Thanks to the shops.
What are we doing?
Thanks to the skate media.
Thanks to Osiris.
What are we doing for the 30th? Where are you going to be? Where are we going to be in 10 years? Is it Death going to be around then?
On the dole.
Hopefully still alive.
YouTube millionaires.
YouTube millionaires.
Death TV coming soon.
Death TV. Yeah. Death USA coming soon.
Death USA. I just want to say, honestly, I didn't want to put Osiris down. Thanks for the shoes, Matt Law. Stoked on the big push.
Guys, if you guys are finished, I'm running out of words. Let's play a clip you guys tore up earlier with Ron from Mark, Dan, Zorlac and myself. We'll see you next time on episode 5 of VHS.
Oh dear, quite limited as to what we can do.
Get the tees on.
Ha ha ha!